Okay, see here we are starting with income tax. Okay, ab suno. Income tax, firstly, what is income tax? And why you have to pay income tax? And what you have to study in income tax? What did I say? I will teach you three things. What is income tax? Why income tax? And what you have to study in income tax? So firstly, what is income tax? It's a tax on your income. Means whatever income we earn, on that some portion we have to give it to government. But some portion means it is some percentage. It can be 30%, 20%, certain percentage of your income you have to give it to government. But how much percentage, that I will explain at a later stage. Right now let's not go into what is the percentage of income which we have to give to the government, but it works on percentage basis. Whatever income we earn, certain percentage of that we have to give it to government. And that is called income tax. And income tax, because it is certain percentage of your income. Depending upon income, we have to give some percentage. That's why it is income tax. But why we have to pay that? Because we use various facilities like roads, flyover, facilities like highway, ceiling, etc. So these are all public infrastructure facilities. And this requires cost. And that cost is incurred by government. And for that, government needs money. So that's why government has started income tax, GST. With that, government is trying to collect as much money as possible from the public, and the same will be spent for the facilities towards public only. Okay. So that basic idea mostly students have, that why government is charging income tax. So the purpose is to provide various facilities to the public. So what did I explain? What is income tax? It's a tax on your income calculated at a certain percentage. And why? Because government wants to provide us various facilities like road, highway, flyover, etc. For that, government is charging income tax. Okay. So these are general things. Now coming to the main point. For a student, what we have to study in this subject? So see, what to study. Now you can look at the screen. What you have to study in this subject? So see, your objective is how to compute income of any person and how to compute tax of any person. That is what you have to learn. So now you will wonder, how to compute income? In this, what sir will teach? If I am earning the income, I know how much I am earning. I can simply total up on my calculator and decide that this is what I want. See, this is not a basic calculation. A person who earns the income, he knows how much he's earning, but not that calculation. Here we have to learn the calculation from government's point of view. And government has got a different rules for calculation of income. And that different rules we have to study in this subject. That what are the rules for computing the income. For example, if you are doing some job somewhere in a company, or if you are having your own business, so you are earning income, that you know. But what are the rules of computing the income? That we have to study here. And if you think right now, what rules in this? But see, once you go into the depth of the subject, you realize there are so many rules we have to study for calculation of income. But let's not go into the what are the rules. If I start teaching all that, the subject will get over today only. The whole journey of income tax subject is about to explain certain percentages. Based on your income, certain percentage you have to calculate as a tax. So calculating tax is not a big deal. For that, there are certain percentages which I have to remember. There also some complications are there, but it is certain percentages which you have to remember. So this is a simple task. The major task is what? How to compute the income of any person. For that, a whole subject is made. And the subject is so much in depth that in inter also you will not study fully. Till CA final you have to study this subject in depth. So you can imagine what things are there in this subject. But it all revolves around how to compute the income of any person. Okay. So this is what you have to study in this subject. Okay. Now, what to study, how to compute income, how to compute tax. Now, next question is, what is the procedure for that? So see, what to study I have explained, but now you have to study computation income, but then how to compute the income. So see, there is a statement for this. In order to read this, what I have written, how to compute the income of any person. to compute income of any person, you have to prepare a statement. There is a statement which you have to prepare, which I will explain right now. For example, when you also start earning, you will also have to prepare this statement. This is so standard statement, every person in India has to prepare this statement if he wants to compute his income. And he will have to compute his income, there is no choice. Once you earn the income, compute the income, compute the tax and pay the tax to the government. And if you say, what if I don't pay the tax to the government, then government will see to it. Government has got various penalty and prosecutions for which actions will be taken. But right now, let's not go into that zone. You have to respect it as a rule that even I will have to earn the income in future. So I will have to prepare this kind of statement. Okay. So now see, in this statement, if you notice, there are five types of income I have written here. Okay. And you will also realize that there are various methods of earning the income, but broadly there are five methods in which you can earn the income. First common method is what? You start doing the job. See, if you don't want the headache of doing your own business, the safest way is what? You have some good qualification, start a job. And once you do the job, your income is income from salaries. So that is the first type of income. Okay. And see, since we are calculating the income, we have to first list down the income. So what is the first possible income? Income from salary. Okay. And then the next income is income from house property. House property income means what, you know, if you got houses and if you give it on rent. So when you give it on rent, so rent income is your income. So that rent income is called income from house property. But precisely it is rent. Huh? If you sell the house property and if you make a profit, then it becomes a capital gains. That is the next thing which is going to come. Right now when I say house, it's not anything and everything from house. It is only the rental income which is called income from house property. Okay. Then next is income from business. Income from business means, for example, I am doing a business of coaching class. So in my business, my income is what? The net profit. I get fees from my students. I have to incur various expenditure. I have to give salary to my teachers, to my staff, etc. After deducting all my expense, whatever net profit I make, that is my income from business. So business income is nothing but it's a net profit which a businessman earns. Okay. Then capital gains. Capital gains means if you sell the property, if you sell some asset, asset can be a house property, it can be shares, it can be debentures, bonds, it can be land, any asset you sell, the profit which you make, profit on sale, that is called capital gains. Okay. Then after this four incomes, any other income, if you can imagine, it is called income from other sources. See, other sources, here you have to feel the word other. Feel the word other. Other means other. Other than 1, 2, 3, 4. Other than these four incomes, all other incomes are called income from other sources. And see, it is not possible to list down each and every income in the statement because, as you know, there are thousands of methods in which you can earn the income. But then broadly, the main types of income we have listed down. And at the end, what we say that if you have got some other income which doesn't fit in salary, which doesn't fit in house property, doesn't fit in business or capital gains, it is called income from other sources. So this way, if you realize, if you notice rather, all the incomes are listed down in the statement. None of the income is skipped. If you say, no, sir, this income we have not taken, it's not possible to say. When we say other sources, means each and every income is covered in the statement. Okay. And then after this five incomes are added, we get a total called gross total income. Okay. And then from the gross total income, there are certain deductions, means you have to minus certain things. Now, what you have to minus, it's not possible to explain now. But at proper time, you will study. See, right now, I'm just giving a summary of the whole subject. It is not the first chapter I have started. It is just a summary and the introduction. Can you see here what I have written? It is just an introduction of the subject, that what is this subject, what we have to study in this subject. We cannot start directly with chapter 1. See, if it is an account subject, accounts you know in advance what is there in accounts, we can directly start with chapter 1. But here it is a new subject for most of the students. So I have to explain that what is there in this subject. So that's what is going on right now. Okay. So in short, this is just an introduction. You can say a brief summary of the whole subject. तो आई वॉज हियर एक्चुअली, देर आर सर्टन डिडक्शंस. नाउ वॉट आर द डिडक्शंस दैट विल स्टडी एट अ लेटर स्टेट, बट समथिंग यू हैव टू माइनस एंड देन वॉट यू गेट इज कॉल्ड नेट टैक्सेबल इनकम. एंड वेन वी से टैक्सेबल इनकम मीन्स इट इज अ इनकम ऑन विच यू हैव टू कैलकुलेट द टैक्स. एंड देन कैन यू सी आई हैव रिटर्न योर टैक्स एट द रेट ऑफ सर्टन परसेंटेज. मीन्स वॉट एवर इज दिस आंसर, मे दिस बी 1 lakh, 10 lakh, 20 lakhs, 1 crore, 2 crore, 20 crores, ऑन दैट सर्टन परसेंटेज यू विल कैलकुलेट एंड दैट मच परसेंट वी हैव टू पे टू द गवर्नमेंट. एंड वंस यू नो टू कैलकुलेट दिस होल थिंग, यू कैन से यू नो इनकम टैक्स. नाउ यू विल वंडर, दिस इज वॉट यू हैव टू स्टडी फॉर दिस, देर इज अ होल सब्जेक्ट. बट सी, डोंट थिंक, डोंट अंडर एस्टिमेट इट, देर आर सो मेनी थिंग्स यू हैव टू स्टडी इन साइड दिस. बट सी, दिस इज द मेन पार्ट ऑफ द सब्जेक्ट. I would not say that this is what you have to only study in income tax. Apart from this, there are other things also. Like there are something called TDS. Have you heard about the tax deduction at source, tax collection at source? So there are other things also. Means how to calculate this income, how to file the return, and how government takes the action on the people who have not filed the return. What is return and all, I will explain. Filing the return means this calculation you have to submit to government. There are many procedural things which you have to study. So I am not saying this is what is there in income tax, that's it. But this is a major part of the income tax. There are other chapters also which are there in our syllabus, but I will come to that at a later stage. But right now you just make an impression that if I know this thing, that means I know majority of the income tax. Okay. Now see here. See, can you see here, there are 5 types of income. These 5 types of income are called 5 heads of income. We call this as 5 heads of income. Say 5 heads. Heads. You should be so familiar with this word. And see, it is not my created word. In the language of income tax, we call them as 5 heads. If you say, what if I say 5 types, don't use your own word. It's better to use the word which is very popular in the language of income tax. And in the language of income tax, we say 5 heads. So if someone tells you that what is the first head of income, you should say income from salary. And what is the 5th head? Income from other sources. So these are called 5 heads of income. Okay, now see. Each income we will have to calculate by preparing a separate statement. Can you see what I highlighted? For example, if I want to know this amount, I will have to separately work out as a working note. See, consider this as the main answer. Okay. And this will be supported by working notes. So in working note 1, you will prepare what? A statement of income from salary. What to say? Statement of income from salary. Means if you are doing job somewhere, so whatever income you earn in your job, so how to prepare a statement of that? See, in tax, we are not going to prepare any accounts. We are going to prepare statements. But in accounts, don't you think, we don't have any statement kind of culture. We have all debit credit account system. But here there is no debit credit system, plus and minus. A statement, plus minus, that kind of approach will be there. Okay. So this statement will give us the amount of income from salary. And that we will write here. Then second working note will be statement of income from house property. Now how to prepare this statement? For this there is a separate topic only. See, for each statement which you can see here, there is a separate chapter to be studied. So this way, see, your index is being developed. In every subject there is an index. So can you imagine how your index will be of this subject? In the index, the chapter 1 will be income from salary. In the index, second chapter will be income from house property. Means full-fledged chapters are there for each income. Okay. And then tell me, how will you calculate this amount? You will have to prepare a separate statement of income from business. Okay. So for that, you are going to solve sums, 10, 15, 20 sums we are going to solve, so that you understand in thorough how to prepare statement of a businessman. And then for capital gains also, there is a separate working. Okay. See, these small boxes I have just given you to give you a hint. Actually, it is not just a small box. It's a big statement of 1 full page, sometimes 2 pages. A big statement is prepared. So this way, for the 5 heads of income, you have to prepare 5 different statements. And 5 different statements will give me 5 answers which you have to gather here together, and then the total of that is called gross total income. Okay, and then this deduction also will be taught in a separate topic. Means there will be one full-fledged topic where you have to study that what we have to deduct in the form of deduction. That is again one chapter. And then how to calculate tax, that again is one chapter. So in this only you can see that in the whole subject what are the upcoming chapters. Can you tell me the upcoming chapters? For five incomes, five chapters: salary, house property, business, capital gains, income from other sources. So five chapters will go in this only, and the sixth chapter will be deductions, and the seventh chapter will be how to calculate the tax. So this way seven chapters will be done. And in this I will not say the whole subject is over. After this there are some other chapters also, but I will call them as sundry chapters. Just to hear the name of this chapter, I can say there is something called residential status, clubbing of income, set off and carry forward, TDS, return filing. Don't try to understand what I am saying. Just keep listening that yes, apart from this, there are some other chapters also that will make up our whole subject of 50 marks. Okay. And trust me, this subject is so interesting. And you know why I am so confidently saying it will be so interesting? You will start loving the subject, because I know I will teach this subject with logic. And if you understand everything with logic, okay, this is the logic behind the rule, we are studying this, but why like this? If you know the why of everything, you will start loving. But if something is imposed on you, why, don't ask me why, you have to do like this only, then you will start hating the subject. But I will never do like that. And in fact, in every subject, your strategy should be to understand the logic. It may happen that sometimes your other teacher, like some other teacher, might forget to tell you the reason behind that. You should ask. Because the teachers are used to teaching, so for them it's normal. But for a student, everything is new. So sometimes if you feel that what is the reason for this, you should ask. You should be having the reason of everything. That if something is done like this, then why? Okay. So here also you should have a question. Sir, why are we preparing this? Why? Because if I prepare this, I will be able to decide what is the amount of tax which I have to pay to government. And why I have to pay to government? Why? Because government wants this money to provide facility to us only. We are walking freely on the road, but road is not free of cost. It has costed something, but that cost who is bearing? Government. So I have to contribute to government. That's why I have to do all this. Okay. So understand everything logically that why this is happening. Okay. Now can you tell me? Okay, wait, before that one more thing. As I said, for this five incomes, you have to prepare five different statements. Okay. Now, these five different statements, when you prepare, don't you think there will be some rules and regulation for preparing the statement? Just as accounts also, when you do, you follow certain rules. Debit the receiver, credit the giver, all assets have debit balance, liabilities have credit balance. Some rules are there in accounts also. So similarly, when you prepare the statements in income tax, even that is governed by some rules. And these rules for you, I will teach you. But where are these rules written? It is written in the income tax law. See here, Income Tax Act 1961, Income Tax Rules 1962. Literally, there are two books. There are two books which has all the rules for preparing this statement. To prepare this statement, there are many rules. That is why a full big subject. And the subject is so big that it doesn't get over at CA Inter. You have to still study at CA Final. So you can imagine the depth of the subject. And for that depth of the subject, there are two books. One book is called Income Tax Act 1961. The other one is Income Tax Rules 1962. Okay. Now see, you don't have to purchase these books from the market. Even if you have the inquisitiveness, I want to purchase these books in the market, you will never understand this. The language is so hi-fi. It is not possible for a layman to understand income tax by purchasing these books available in the market. Okay. So this is just a reference. I have to tell you that whatever I am teaching you in the simplest manner, the source of our knowledge is this. Income Tax Act 1961, Income Tax Rules 1962. Okay. Now since it is an act, there are sections. See, whenever law makes act and rules, this way they make two books. Do you know what is the reason for this? All the main rules they write it in the act. But sometimes you know, दे वॉन्ट टू एलाबरेट समथिंग मोर इन डिटेल. तो वेन एवर द गवर्नमेंट वॉन्ट्स टू एलाबरेट समथिंग मोर इन डिटेल दे पुट इट इन अ सेपरेट बुक कॉल रूल्स. बिकॉज सी इफ एवरीथिंग दे पुट इट इन वन सिंगल बुक द एक्ट विल बिकम वेरी लेंथी. सो इन ऑर्डर टू कीप द इनकम टैक्स एक्ट कंसाइज वॉट दे डू वेर एवर दे फील दे वॉन्ट टू एग्जैजरेट और दे वॉन्ट टू पुट एक्स्ट्रा रूल्स इन डेप्थ दे पुट इट इन इनकम टैक्स रूल 1962. ओके बट ऑल द मेन रूल्स आर गिवन इन इनकम टैक्स एक्ट 1961. ओके नाउ सी हियर एज आई सेड वी हैव टू स्टडी द रूल्स विच आर गिवन इन इनकम टैक्स एक्ट 1961 एंड इनकम टैक्स रूल 1962. बट दिस एक्ट इज नॉट स्टैटिक. It keeps changing. It's dynamic. It keeps changing. As you know, every year there is a budget. Yes. And whenever a budget comes, there are some changes made in this Income Tax Act. Obviously, budget is not just made for Income Tax Act. Budget tries to regulate the whole economy. The whole economy doesn't depend upon income tax. So, in budget, they make other rules also. But in income tax, whatever changes are brought, it is brought in the budget. Okay. Now, since every year there is a budget, that means for every year, rules change. Income, these rules I am talking about, these rules do not same forever. For example, I did my CA, I finished my CA in 97. At the time when I studied my CA, I had studied some different rule. But 97, now it is 24. Okay. So, every year the rules keep changing. So, I have to explain the latest rule. And latest means what you know? Rules which are applicable for 23-24. Financial year 23-24. For this year, whatever rules are applicable, that will be taught to you. Because see, I cannot teach you the rules which I studied when I was a student. Okay. After that, so many years have passed. Every year the rule changes. See, when I say rule changes, it doesn't mean it changes completely. But out of say 1000 rules, one or two rule keeps changing. Minor changes. But that minor changes, if someone doesn't know, his answer goes wrong in the exam. So there are some minor changes. But that minor changes takes place every year. So I will teach you rule of which year? Should I teach you the rule which I studied in my exam? Obviously no. After that I have taken so many batches in my 25 years experience. So obviously I will explain the latest rules. And the latest rules are the rules which are applicable for financial year 23-24. And when I say financial year, it is April to March. In income tax, never think Jan to December. It is always April to March. Whereas in accounts, your accounting year can be anything. But in income tax, never in your dream you can think that, sir, what if we go as per Jan to December? No. Jan to December is a calendar year. Calendar year approach is not applicable in income tax. We have to follow financial year, means April to March approach, okay? And for us, which April to March is relevant? 23-24. See here, for this I have drawn something. Look here. See, in income tax, see, this is the last thing. Thereafter, I will start the first chapter. In introduction, this is the last thing, then chapter 1 will start. Now, see, in income tax, in 1 year you have to earn the income. And then whatever income you earn in one particular year, on that you have to pay the tax in the next year. Why in the next year? You cannot pay the tax in the same year. Because let me earn the income. See, first, for the first year I am busy in earning the income. And what law says, you earn the income nicely for 12 months. 12 months means from April to March, you nicely earn the income. Don't worry about the tax. First you earn the income. And by 31st March, I will come to know how much income I earned. And once I know my income, then I can pay the tax in the next year. And you know the year in which you pay the tax is called assessment year. It is called assessment year. Why it is called assessment year? Because your this year's income is being calculated. And when your income is being calculated, we say it is being assessed. So tell me, when your income is calculated, in the same year or in the next year? In the next year. So in the next year, my income is being calculated, and calculation means assessment, and that calculated income is checked by government also. See, first I will do the calculation, then government will also will check that whether you have done the calculation proper or not, because sometimes people don't do the calculation properly to save the tax. So you calculate and then government checks. So feel the word calculation, checking, all this means what? Assessment. That is why this year is called assessment year, because in this year calculation takes place, and after our calculation government does the checking. That's why it's called assessment year. Okay, and tell me, as I said, in this year you will do the calculation. Calculation of what? Income. Income and tax of which year? Of the last year. Okay, not of the this of the same year. See, in this year you are busy in earning fresh income, but the calculation which you do at a time, it is of the last year. So that's why the last year is called previous year. So you know, it has become a very common term for government. The year in which a person earns the income, government says it's the previous year. They call it as a previous year only. See, be familiar with this word throughout the whole journey of income tax. I will keep saying previous year assessment year, previous year assessment year. So you should not feel confused. Whenever I say previous year, what you should imagine? It is a year when income was earned. And when I say assessment year, it is a year when tax is paid and calculation is being done. Okay. But although the years are two, but we are targeting only 1 year. See, the target is this year only. It is here just that in this year income was generated, and that same year's income, this year income was generated, and that same year's income is being taxed in the next year. Okay, so it is 1 year's income only, but for that there are 2 years involved. The year when you generated the income will be called previous year, and for that when you pay the tax in the next year, that will be called as assessment year. Okay, and see, I have not written here casually 23-24. It is not casually written. For your exam, the applicable previous year will be 23-24 only. Didn't I say sometimes back, I am going to teach you the rules which are applicable for income earned during 23-24. Means whoever has earned the income during 23-24. For example, right now, what is the date today? 4th April. Okay, so 4th April has just, we have just crossed the 31st March. So whoever has earned the income in the previous year, we will say previous only, obviously, because now we have come to April. So in April, this March has gone. So whoever has earned the income in the previous year, 23-24, for that the applicable rules which you have to study. Okay, and see, there is a logic behind this, that why you have to study the rules for 23-24, you know. Because you are going to give exam when? Your exam is in November 24. Okay, so see, let me search our November 24. When is our exam? See, precisely here. So obviously, a student sitting in an exam for November 24, so that is the year which is going on. So that is assessment year. But the year which has passed is what? 23-24. That year's income you have to compute. In short, whenever you are going to solve the questions on income tax, in the question, you know what they will ask? Calculate the income, Mr. Sharma. Calculate the income, Mr. Shenoy, for the previous year 23-24. Always the question will be framed like this only. Calculate the income for the previous year. They will always write previous year. And that also they will write 23-24 only. Never in your dream you imagine that what if in our exam they say calculate the income for the previous year 2021. Impossible. Because asking you to calculate the income for previous year 2021, that means you are supposed to know the rules of 2021. That is not possible. A student has to study the rule for 1 year. You are not expected to know the rules of all the years. It is impossible for a student. Even if you ask me right now, what was the rule 10 years behind, I have forgotten. Because I am busy into the current law. So for a student, it's impossible that they will expect a knowledge from you of a year which is past. So for your relevant previous year is what you know, 23, 24, okay? And call it as previous year only, because you are going to solve the question, they will ask how the subject will move on. As I said, this is a summary of the whole subject, so I will take you in this line only. So can you guess what should be my first chapter? Yes, in the order, first comes income from salary. But see, salary being the very lengthy topic, the most lengthy topic, I will not start with income from salary. I will start with income from other sources, which is actually a small topic. And starting with the small topic, giving you comfort in a new subject is my main objective. Suddenly if I can teach anything from anywhere right now. But I don't have to think from my point of view. I have to think from a student who has newly started the subject. So for your convenience, the best chapter to start with is income from other source. I know it will sound little weird, but trust me, this is the best chapter to start with. Soon you will realize after few lectures, okay? By the time you reach the midway of the subject, you will realize, thank God sir has first taught us income from other sources. Because although this is a small topic, but the rules taught in this topic will be coming across to you in every topic which you study. And if I keep it at the end, it will create a trouble. Because see, trust me, for example, when I teach you income from business, that time some knowledge of income from other source will be required. Although as per the order of the law, it is the last income. But I have to teach. I don't have to simply make a law. And for teaching, every topic, sometimes or the other, this knowledge is required, so it will create a disturbance. So best is to start with income from other source, okay? And see, I've seen past students, some of my students, they were shocked. Means some students who are actually not my student, they say, how can sir start with income from other sources? See, they are all traditional minded. The first chapter is something else only. So see, trust me, whenever you come across some other books, finding the list of chapter in some different order, please ignore them. Trust me, I can give you the best and the simplest method with my approach, okay? So I am telling you so much, you know, right now, because students have questioned me, sir, why do you start with this? Why means you study and see, you will come to know. Because I don't want to confuse you. I want to convince you and make the subject lovable. So for that, this is the best subject to start with, okay? Sorry, best chapter to start with. So our first chapter is income from other sources, okay? Now, can you tell me in this chapter what I will explain? Means what will be the type of sums we will be solving? In this chapter, we will study how to prepare a statement of income from other sources. So whatever questions we are going to solve, you have not seen the questions also, but whatever may be the question, your answer will be statement of income from other sources. And this statement is not in debit credit form, plus minus, but you have to simply be aware of the rule, what to plus, what to minus, bus. That's it. And it will be so simple, trust me. What is difficult in this subject, you know, remembering. Initially, some rules you will find it very easy to remember. But one day you will realize there are so many rules to be remembered. So in this subject, it's all about remembering. And if you have the good memory or good revising skill, see, not saying good memory, let it be an average memory. But you should have the habit of revising regularly. Then you will be confident in this subject. Okay. So we'll start with income from other sources. That is our first chapter. Look at this. Now, as I said, income from other sources, here you need to fill the word other. Other means what? Other than these four incomes. What are the four main heads? Salary, income, these are short forms. Huh? Income from salary, income from house property, income from business, capital gains. These are the main four heads. Apart from these four incomes, all remaining incomes are called income from other sources. Now see, what remaining incomes you can imagine, tell me. Means apart from these four incomes, what other incomes can you have? You can get dividend income, you can get bank interest, you can win in lottery, okay, you can get some commission income. So there are many incomes. So see, देयर कैन बी सो मेनी टाइप्स ऑफ इनकम इन दिस वर्ल्ड विच कैन फॉल इन इनकम फ्रॉम अदर सोर्सेज, बट द इनकम विच यू यूजली फाइंड इन क्वेश्चन, फॉर दैट आई हैव गिवन अ कीवर्ड हियर. सी इन दिस कीवर्ड आई विल एक्सप्लेन इन दिस सम्स विच यू सॉल्व वॉट आर द इनकम विच यू नोटिस. सी इफ आई आस्क यू टू इमेजिन एनी अदर इनकम, यू कैन इमेजिन एनी इनकम. And most of the other income which are possible, it is covered in this keyword. Can you see one keyword I have written here? How will you pronounce it? D, W, Ramu, Fakir, G, etc. How to pronounce this? I know it sounds funny, but trust me, one day you will feel with this keyword, whole subject is over. Sorry, whole chapter is over. Not subject, whole chapter is over. So what is the keyword? D, W, Ramu, Fakir, G. D, W, Ramu, Fakir, G. Actually, you know what is this? These are the different types of income which fall under income from other sources. So, one by one, I will tell you the full form of these incomes. And see, as a student, you are not just supposed to know the name of the income. For example, D for dividend income. See, dividend income you also heard. But here you will have to study now whether this income is taxable or exempt. For each item in this keyword, there is some income involved. The income, when I say, you have heard that income. But then what you have to study? That on that income, do I have to pay tax or not? And actually see, on almost all your income, you have to pay the tax. But there are few incomes on which government does not charge the tax. So tell me, if government says on this income, we are not going to charge the tax, it is a happy feeling or not? It is a very happy feeling, because no one wants to pay the tax. Everyone wants the income, but they don't want to pay the tax. So if that is the income on which you don't have to pay the tax, government says it is exempt. Exempt means it is free from tax. But you will find few incomes only which are exempt. Most of the incomes are taxable. The whole income tax is for taxing the income. So obviously most of our incomes are taxable only. But at least few incomes are exempt. So you are supposed to know which incomes are exempt. See, actually, when a student is taught accounts, what is the language of accounts? Debit, credit, debit, credit. What is the language of maths? Plus, minus, divide, multiply. What is the language of tax? Taxable exempt, taxable exempt, taxable exempt. You know why I am telling this? Because it's a new subject for you. So in this subject, my way of communication will be what you know. I will keep explaining, dear student, this income is taxable. Dear student, this income is exempt. My language will be this only, taxable exempt, taxable exempt, taxable exempt. But in some chapter, my language will be allowed, not allowed, allowed, not allowed. You know, that depends upon what? If I am teaching about some income, my tone will be taxable exempt. If I say taxable means, this is the income, on this you have to pay the tax. And majority incomes are like that only. But if I say exempt, that means this is an income on which you don't have to pay the tax. You will feel happy. So when I teach about income, my language will be taxable exempt, taxable exempt. But when I teach about expenses, my language will be allowed, not allowed. Like in a business, see my business. If you see my business, I am a businessman running a coaching class. In my business, you can also imagine there are many expenses. So for expenses, a student has to learn whether it is allowed to be minused or it is not allowed. So it is allowed to be minused, it's a happy feeling. Why? Tell me, from the fees of the students, if I am allowed to minus some expense, my profit will be less, my tax will be less. So allowed is a happy feeling. But if government says, no, this expenditure you incur, that's your problem. It is not allowed. Not allowed means? From the fees of your student, you cannot minus. So if I am not allowed to minus, my income will be more, I will have to pay more tax. Yes. See, why I am saying this, you know, this is a language in which we communicate in tax. Okay. So, language of accounts, debit and credit. Language of maths, plus, minus, multiply, divide. Okay. And the language of tax is taxable exempt, taxable exempt, taxable exempt. And if it is an expenditure, allowed, not allowed, allowed, not allowed. Okay. But see, this is a list of not expense, huh? This D, W, Ramu, Fakir, G is a list of incomes. So here what I will have to teach you, taxable or exempt, taxable or exempt, okay. And whenever I say something is exempt, You should ask me why, sir. See, if I say taxable, please don't ask me why. Because income is meant to be taxed. So if some income is taxable, in fact, you should think it is obviously income hai, toh we have to pay tax. But if I say something is exempt, that is surprise you. Why exempt? On this, we don't have to pay tax, but why? That why also you should know. Okay. So see, starting with first, D. W. Ramu Fakir. In that first, D stands for dividend income. Dividend income, what is dividend income? When you invest in shares, by investing in shares, you get dividend. So when you get dividend, it is an income. Now that income is taxable. It is not exempt. Okay. Most of the incomes are taxable only. Okay. So dividend income is taxable. Wait, someone is doubt? Yeah. You see, so I'll tell you his doubt. See, dividend you get from company, and company gives dividend from its profits. So on profits, company also has to pay tax. Imagine I am a shareholder in Reliance. So when Reliance has made the profit, don't you think Reliance has paid the tax on its profits? And on that same taxed profits, shareholder gets dividend, he has to pay the tax again. So this is a typical case of double taxation in India. And if you say why this is unfair, yes, it is unfair. But we don't have a solution for this. And still, if you have a question, but then how can government be so unfair? So see, what is the thinking of government? You know, there is a huge gap between a company and its investors. For example, if I am a shareholder of Reliance, do you think I am a friend of Ambani? There is a big, I can say I am a shareholder, I am owner of the company, I am owner. We are just so-called owner. But you also know there is a huge gap between shareholder and the company. So if I am a shareholder Reliance, so between me and Reliance, there is a huge distance. It is not there, my friends and family. So because of that huge distance, you know what law says? Reliance is different. If Reliance has paid tax on its profits, they are different people. And you are different. So government is differently taxing us. Although the profits is same, on which first Reliance paid the tax, and that profit when it came to shareholder's pocket, he has to again pay the tax. But this is a way to collect more revenue from public. And as you know, corporates like Reliance, they make huge profits. So government also expects that on their profits, they should get more collection. But still, whatever justification I give you, it hurts when you feel it's a double tax. You also felt double tax or not? Your company has to pay tax on the profits, and that same profit is distributed to the shareholder, on that shareholder has to pay the tax again. But can't help, the main reason is company wants more tax from corporate entities because they have huge profits potential. Okay. Anyways, right now when I'm talking about dividend, think from a shareholder point of view. So if I'm a shareholder, if I get dividend, is it exempt or taxable? Taxable. Okay. Then W stands for winnings. Winnings means if you win something in a lottery or if you win in Kaun Banega Crorepati. So when you win, so it's an income. See, for every income you check, it is not falling in this four category or not. You should check. See, just because I am teaching you, you should not have blind faith. You should have screening. You should check. Winnings, does it fall in salary? No. Is it income from house property? No. Is it your business? No. Is it capital gains? No. See, in capital gains, you sell the asset. But if you win a lottery, it doesn't fit in the four heads. What did I say? Four heads. So obviously, it will go to the last head. So winnings. But now the main question is it taxable or exempt? See, that should be your main inquisitiveness. See, if I talk about some income, you should think I also know these are incomes. Teach us the main thing, taxable or exempt. So ask taxable, ask me to ask, then answer. Taxable or exempt, you asked me, so listen now. It is taxable. Why it should be exempt? If you are winning the lottery, you are happy to earn the winnings from lottery, so pay tax to government. So this income is also taxable. Okay. Now see, after some time you'll feel, sir, most of the incomes are taxable only. But see, after 100 incomes also, even if 5 incomes comes to exempt, it becomes a matter to remember. And then you'll say, out of 100, only 5 I can remember. This is not the only chapter. There are so many things. So majority incomes will be taxable, but then you have to wait. Once you come across an income which is exam, it becomes a point to be remembered and by-hearted and memorized. But up till now, two incomes were taxable. Then next, R stands for rent income. Now see, when I say rent income, you should think, rent income has already come here. Rent income is already come in, income from house property. But that is rent from house. That means what? You can get rent from other assets also. What do you think? House is the only asset in this earth? There are other assets like furniture, plant and machinery. It can be an open land. See, firstly, what is house, you know? House means any structure of four wall and a roof. In Hindi, we say, char diwar chhat. In Hindi, we say, any structure of char diwar and a chhat. Or in English, we say, any structure of four walls and a roof, that is house. You know, this definition is very important because many students asked me, sir, I have a shop. If I give the shop on rent, then what? But sir, it's a shop. I say income from house property. Yes, sir, but sir, it's a shop. Let it be shop. Whether it is a shop or a factory, once it is a structure of four walls and a roof, for government it's one and the same. See why I'm saying? Because sometimes students innocently think house means the place where I stay, people stay. Not necessary. Even if a godown is there, godown is not a place where you start living, but it is a place of four wall and a roof. So any structure of four wall and a roof, in the eyes of government, it's a house. See, house means a place where you can take shelter. See, we don't stay in a godown. But tell me, if there is a heavy rain outside, don't you try to go inside the godown, take the shelter? You will forget then godown, water, everything. You will start living there also. If you are scared in outside environment. Okay. So any place where you can take shelter, in other words, any structure of four wall and a roof, it is house property in the eyes of government. So from that, if you get rent, then it can come from house property. But if you get rent from something which is not four wall and a roof, something else like machinery, a computer, air condition, furniture, then it is not income from house property. Then it is income from other sources. Then it will come in R in the Ramu. Can you see? Ramu starts with R. So the first R is rent of other assets. The main question is, sir, is it taxable or exempt? Taxable. Most of the incomes are taxable, only few will be exempt. It is taxable. But see, can you see here there are three R's?
Yes.
That means there are three rents. First rent was rent from other assets other than four wall roof structure. Second rent is called rent from subletting. Now subletting is a rent from house only. Subletting word is used for house. But then listening to house again, you should say, sir, it is an income from house property. But you know, income from house property said when the owner gets the rent. But in subletting, tenant is getting the rent. Tenant means the one who pays the rent. So imagine, this is a property in which I am the owner. So when owner gets the rent, it is income from house property, okay? But now imagine, this is not a place owned by me. I am just a tenant. But I am not using it, I have given to someone else. So when a rented house is given on further rent, it is subletting. See, the main letting is from the owner's side. But when a rented house is further again given on rent, it becomes a subletting, then it becomes income from other sources. See, this chapter is meant for owners who get the rent. So see, best example, if I take the example of this classroom, actually this is not the classroom owned by me. It is a rented place for me. But I am using for my coaching class. But what if I feel this class remains empty only, no students are coming, class remains empty only, I have taken the place on rent but I am not able to use it. Then what I can do? I can give this class on rent to someone else. Then it is income from subletting, income from other sources. Okay. So see, you should analyze two special features of house property, you know. Firstly, it should be a structure of four walls and a roof. And secondly, you should be owner. then only you can say income from house. You know, when you can rightfully house, when you are the owner. But even you are not the owner, you yourself have taken on rent, you don't have right to use the word house. But still that rented premise, you are further giving your rent and earning the rent. There is an income, but it is income from other source. And that is typically called as rent from subletting. Actually, letting means giving on rent. But if I just say letting, 4, 5, how many incomes are there? 5. I have copied here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. All incomes I copied here. But then you have to use your brain in the amount column. And how will you use the brain? If you come across some taxable incomes, you should put the amount. But if you come across some exempt income, you should put a dash. Dash means dash. You have not put the amount. That means it is not included in the totaling. And obviously it should not be included in the total. If it gets included in the total, you know where this total will go? Tell me where this total will go. I'll tell you where this total will come here. And on this you will have to pay tax. But on one hand we are saying the income is exempt. That means on that you don't have to pay the tax. So obviously you should not include such income in the totaling. Although for presentation's sake, I have to show the name of the income. But in the amount column, amount or dash, it will be dash. See, some students have asked me, but then sir, what if we don't write only? Yes, you have a choice to not write the exempt income, but then you have to write a note for that. But that will consume time. Writing a notes after the sum is over, it's boring. And sometimes you forget also. So don't take the chance, but that alternative is valid. That alternative is valid because see, there is no standard format that you have to prepare statement like this only. Government does not regulate those things. So there is a choice that if there is some exempt income, don't include in the statement, write it as a note. But I will not prefer that approach. What I will prefer, simply copy all the incomes of the question in the statement, just copy everything. But if something is taxable, write the amount. If something is exempt, put dash. So see, in my example, first two incomes were taxable. So I have written two amounts. Then third income was exempt. So I have put dash. Watch the screen. Then taxable amount, exempt dash. And then finally you will total up. And did you notice in the total, did you add all five incomes or only three incomes? Only. That becomes my taxable income from other sources. Now what to do this with this figure? This will be put in the main mega statement. Main grand statement. See, this is just a working note kind of thing. Although in the first chapter, this will be my main answer. Because we are studying step by step. Okay. So right now in this chapter, this is my main answer. Once this is over, sum is over. But in real life, the thing doesn't get over here. This amount goes where? In the statement of total income. It will come here. And this way, five incomes are accumulated. And then further, there are some deductions, then tax. See, don't break the chain. Understand the chain properly. Because if that chain is in your mind clearly, that I will do this, then this will go here, this will go here, this will go here. That means your concept is very clear. Okay. So, actually I was explaining the D.W. Ramu. In between, I suddenly started and explained you that what will be given in the question, what will be given in the answer, what will be there in the answer. Okay. So now, tell me, if in the question you come across dividend, what you will do? Tax. But you will put amount or dash? Amount. See, while you are studying the theory, imagine as if you are solving a sum only. Feel this as a question only. In the question, all these incomes are given. So your imagination should be, how will I write in the answer? So visualize, dividend is given in the question. So I will prepare a statement. I will write dividend. And in the amount column, I will write amount. I will write amount because sir said it is taxable. So taxable, that means it should be included in the statement. Okay. Winnings also taxable. You will put the amount. Rent also taxable. You will put the amount. What was the first rent? Rent of other asset. Second was subletting. means when a rented property is given on further rent. Okay. See, I will show you this thing also. Look here. In the answer, as I said, a statement will be prepared. So look here. What is the first thing I taught? Dividend. Can you see I have written the amount? That means when you are also solving the sum, write the amount, taxable. Then what was the next thing I taught you? Winnings. So see, magic. Winnings. Why did I write the amount? Because it is taxable. Okay. Then rent income. How many rents are there? Three. I explained to you what was the first rent? Rent from other assets. So see, I have written the amount or dash. Amount because it is taxable. Okay, then what was the second one? Subletting. Yes, subletting means what? See, can you understand with this drawing? Yeah. What does this drawing say? X rented a property to Y. Rented means let out. We say let out. So, X is the main owner. So, for X, it is income from house property. That will not come in this statement. But think from Y point of view. What Y has done? Rented property further given on rent. So Y will get rent income from
Z.
Z. Can you see Y is getting rent income? So for Y it will be income from other sources. And so when Y will prepare income from other source statement, he will write the amount over here. Okay. So to give more clarity, I'll do one thing. This will not come here. I put a cross mark. And this will come. Because this thing comes in income from house property. This thing comes in income from other source. Okay. Now see, there is one more rent. Composite rent. What do you mean by the word composite? Composite means combined. See, if I exclusively give a four wall roof structure on rent, it is income from house property. But sometimes the structure is such that inside the four walls there are machines, furniture, computer, air condition all installed, and I have given all together on rent. So it becomes a composite. Composite means combined. You didn't feel combined?
Yes.
What combination you found? Mainly there was a structure of four wall and a roof. Best is imagine a factory kind of structure. A factory is usually a four wall and a roof. But inside the factory, imagine machines are installed. Air conditioner, everything is installed. And it has become a common structure with house, machines, furniture, air conditioner, all installed. And if I give this whole thing on rent, so that means I am getting rent from four wall and roof also. Plus other asset like machines also. So it becomes a mixed combined rent. So you know, in such case, ideally what you should do, you should try to separate the rent. Means to whomsoever who have given the property on rent, you should make a separate agreement. What separate agreement? That for my four wall and roof, give me this much rent. For my machine, furniture, blah blah blah, give me this much rent. So if two different rent figures are available, then it is very simple. Then what? The rent for the four wall and roof structure will go to income from house property. And the rent from other assets will come here in income from other sources. Then it is not composite. Then I am writing other assets only. But sometimes when you give such property on rent, you don't make the breakup. You make a single agreement only. Your agreement with the tenant, there is an agreement when you let out the property, you make a single agreement. And in the single agreement, there is no bifurcation. Bifurcation of what is the rent of the four wall and roof and what is the rent of machines, etc. If that breakup is not there, then the whole mixed rent you have to put here. And then it becomes a composite rent. Because see, if the rent is combined, you are not able to break it up. Then it is not possible that you take it here. Because house property has got its own identity. And its identity is what? Pure four walls and roof. You cannot put any scrap in that. So if the rent is so much mixed that you are not able to separate other assets from the four wall and roof, it cannot be brought to house property. Then you got no choice but to take it in income from other sources. In short, conclusion is what you know, whenever so many assets are let out together in a single agreement, so you should try to see if there are two separate rents available. Two means one for house and other for other asset like machines, etc. If two figures are available, then we can break up. Then what to do? Answer, then the one pertaining to house will come in income from house property, and the portion which pertains to other asset will come in income from other source. And see, don't forget, for this there is a separate statement, and for this there is a separate statement. So two amounts will go to the respective statements. Just in accounts we prepare different accounts. This will go in this account, this will go in this account. We don't prepare different accounts. Yeah, different statements are there. So the component of house rent will go to the statement of house property, and the component of other asset will go to statement of income from others. But that is if the breakup is available. But if the breakup is not available, then full combined amount will come here. But it is taxable. Till now, no income has come which is exempt in our theory. So see what I have written here. Read. Composite rent of building plus other assets. See, in exam they don't you write the word composite. But how will you come to know? You know, whenever you find that there is building, actually building and house is one and the same. Huh? Don't get me, sometimes sir says house, sometimes building. Any four wall with a roof on top, it's a building. You call house, you call anything. See, you have to take it in a larger, broader manner, that if there is a four wall and a roof, it's house also, or you can also call it as building also. Okay, here building doesn't literally mean a building of 2-story, 5-story, 10-story. Even if there is a small room with four wall and a roof, then it is a building, or you can say house. But for us it is all one and the same. Okay, so building plus other asset, this combination if appears in the question, that means it's a composite rent. Put the whole rent here. But if you are able to bifurcate, ignore this, then write only this much. Then so it will become my first R.
Yes.
Rent of other assets. Okay. So dividend income taxable, winnings income taxable, and then for rent you remember like this: rent, taxable, other assets, subletting, composite rent. Keep bi-hatting also: other assets, subletting and composite rent. All the rents are taxable. Okay. Now comes Ramu A. A for agricultural income. Agricultural income, if it is in India, it is free from tax, exempt. Why? See, whenever any income is exempt, you have to ask me why. But don't worry, before you ask me, my nature is to explain the reason of everything. But your mind should also synchronize with my nature, okay? So agricultural income exempt, so you should have a question, why? You think? And I have the habit of thinking on your own. Because India is agricultural country, and agriculture gives us food of our livelihood. So it should be given importance. To give importance to agriculture, government of India says that anyone who is engaged in agricultural activity, even if you earn the income in crores, you don't have to pay the tax. Because of agriculture, every person is able to have his food and livelihood. So it is the lifeline. Okay. So to give importance to agriculture, government has made the income tax free. And see, the one advantage is what you know, once you come to know that agriculture income is exempt, you will also feel like doing agriculture. You will say, instead of starting a coaching class where if I make the profit, I will have to pay the tax, it's better I start doing agriculture. At least in agriculture, I will get the income and there is no need to pay the tax. So there is one incentive. And government says, most welcome, we don't want that. If everyone does agriculture, people will able to get their livelihood. But see, agriculture is exempt if it is in India. What if I have a agriculture land in China and I am doing farming and agriculture activity in China? Then it is not exempt. Because you are doing agriculture in China, You are feeding Chinese people? Now if I say, no, no, I do agriculture by bring the agriculture production in India, that is not important. You are doing agriculture in China, so that will not be a tax-free income. It will be taxable. But see, here some student had a doubt, but sir, if I do agriculture in China, why government of India is taxing me? That is also one question. So see, government says, you get income from China or Dubai or USA or London. You are staying in India. You want to stay in India, pay the tax. Don't say my income is from China or London. Wherever you get the income from, if you want to reside in India, pay the tax. Yes, if you are staying in China only and you earn China only, then government will not bother you. You heard what I said? You stay in China only and you earn income China only, then government will not bother you. But you want to stay in India, so it is your duty to pay tax in India. Then no matter the income is coming from India or China or any corner of the world. Okay. So in short, if agriculture income is coming from a foreign country, I will have to pay tax to Indian government. Yes. But if it is in India, it is tax free. But see, who says it is exempt? Obviously, I am saying. But where this rule is written? These rules are written where? In Income Tax Act 1961. So in Income Tax Act, there is one section 10. 1. This section says, agriculture income in India will not be taxed. It is free from tax, it is exempt. So you should know the section number also. Okay. So section number 10.1. But see, to give you one relief, all the income which are exempt will have a main section 10 only. Only the bracket will change. Right now in the bracket it was 10.1. So it is 1. But sometimes it will be 10.2. 10.10, this subsection will keep changing, the clause inside the bracket, okay? But the main section is 10 whenever it is an exempt income. Everything will not have section 10, especially for exempt incomes, it is 10 only. So see, but tell me, if in the question you find agriculture income, what you will do? What you will do? First you will check, is it in India or foreign? Tell me, what if the problem is silent? Whenever problem is silent, think positive, it should be in India only. And anyways, we are all Indian people, Indian students, so it is better to assume it is in India. So what to do? Exempt. Exempt means how will you present in the answer?
No.
You will put dash. But in the bracket, you have to write the section number also. See precisely how, you know, look. See, this thing is kind of a template of my answer only. See, since I don't have a place here, it is in the next page, look. What is it? Agriculture income. If it is in India, I have put dash. But see, whenever you put dash, the paper checker will get angry. Why are you putting dash? Why are you putting dash? So you have to relax him. Dear paper checker, it is exempt. So if you don't write this thing, he will get angry and he will deduct the marks. In short, you have to write the section. Because see, question has given you the amount. And you are nicely putting dash. So you have to give reason for that. Okay. See, when you put the amount, you don't have to give the reason. It is understood. It is taxable. But when there is something exempt, you have to write this section in the bracket. Okay. And if the agriculture income is in foreign, then it will be taxable. Okay. So, A we have done. Wait, some student has a doubt. Yeah. See here. See, a student has a doubt like this. Sir, agricultural products, when they are sold in the shop, they are taxable. But see, here you have to understand, the main farmer is exempt from tax. For example, I have a agriculture land, I do farming there, and I produce sugar cane, what else you have, rice, wheat, bajra, etc. And when I sell this, for me it is exempt. But when I sell this to some shopkeeper, and shopkeeper further sells and make the profit, he has to pay tax. He is not doing the farming. The farmer is given the important salute to farmers, not the people ahead in the line. Retailer, wholesaler, distributor, they will have to pay tax. Just because I say I have a shop where I am selling only agriculture products, wheat, bajra, etc. But you are a shopkeeper, you are not a farmer. Exemption is meant for the farmer, okay? And see, one more thing, since he has touched this point, let me tell you one more thing. See, the farmer, if he does farming and he sells the production, it is exempt. But sometimes the farmer doesn't do the farming. He gives it on rent to someone, let someone else do the farming. Then rental income is also agriculture income. See, farmer has two choice. Either you do self farming and sell the production, then it is exempt under section 10(1). Or what farmer can do? He doesn't know farming. What he can do? He will give the farm on rent. So giving agricultural rent or rent is also treated as agriculture income. Mean the main land, which is a source of agriculture, whatever income that land gives me, whether by way of rent or farming activity, that is exempt. Okay. So in case in the question you find rent from an agriculture land, so because it is from agriculture land, it automatically becomes agriculture income in India exempt. Otherwise, see, if I would not have told this point, what student would have done? Sir has told rent income is taxable. I told you it's correct. Yes. But then if the rent is from an agriculture land, it's from a farm. So it becomes an agriculture income only. So in short, in agriculture, there are two ways of earning. Either you yourself do the farming or you give it on rent. Both the incomes are exempt provided the land is in India. So this is done. Then Ramu. In Ramu, the next alphabet is M. Okay. Now M stands for, look at this, M for income of minor children. Income of minor children. Minor children means the children who has not attained the age of 18 years. Below 18. Okay. So imagine if I have minor children, if they earn the income. So income is earned by minor. But tax is not paid the minor. Tax is paid by mummy or papa, whosever income is higher. Mummy or papa, whosever income is higher. For example, see, I have got two children. My son, elder son, he has become 18 years old. Okay. And my younger daughter, she has just become 16 now. Okay. So my younger daughter is minor because 16 years means below 18. So she is minor. So my daughter, whatever income she earns, for example, she has from her account some investments are made in share market and she gets dividend income. Who? My daughter. She is minor. Then who will pay tax? Either me or my wife, whosoever income is higher. So for example, my wife is earning more than me. Then my wife will have to pay tax on my daughter's income. But my wife will show where in income from other sources. Maybe my wife is doing job. So for my wife, the main income is salary. Salary the first head, okay? But that daughter's income will come in my wife's income from other source. Okay? Now see, you will have a doubt. But sir, why minor's income, why minor doesn't pay the tax? Why his parents have to pay the tax? So see, this reason you should know. Don't think you know the reason. Whatever you are guessing is wrong. Whatever you are guessing is wrong. The reason for taxing mummy papa for the income of minor child is totally different, which you cannot imagine now and which is not possible for me to teach now. It will be taught in a separate topic called clubbing. There is one chapter called clubbing of income. What? Clubbing of income. That time I will be able to explain the real reason that why minor's income is taxable in the hands of parents. See, try to learn the language of taxes. See the way I said, why minor's income is taxable in the hands of parents. So the reason you will be able to understand that time only. See, right now, even if I would not touch the point, you might have thought, why minor? How come minor will pay the tax? See, that is not the reason, because he's small. Government has got some different reason only, which is not proper to discuss in the first lecture of taxation. Because once you know so many other, like there are some tax rates, see I told you or not, some income tax percentages you are supposed to know. When you have the knowledge of percentages, after that only I will be able to convince. that why minor income is taxable in the hands of parents, okay? But till that time, you just buy it as a rule that whenever minor has the income, he or she will not pay the tax. Who will pay the tax?
Parents.
But within parents, who? Father or mother? Whosever income is higher. But the parent who pays the tax of minor's income will get exemption of 1,500 per child. The parent who pays the tax on minor's income will get an exemption of 1,500 per minor child. So, for example, as I said, my two children, one is major, my daughter is minor, and my minor has income of say 10,000. So, that 10,000 income will be taxed in whose hands? Father or mother, whosever income is higher. But whoever pays will not pay on full 10,000. From that deduct 1,500. After deducting 1,500, what you get? That amount will be taxable in the parent whose income is higher. Now again, you should have a doubt, sir, why 1,500? Why such an odd amount, 1,500? What is the reason? Please, I will not be able to explain now, because there are certain things to be explained at the right time only. If I try to strive, no, I will explain today only. I will start the whole subject with a confusion. But trust me, one fine day, when we are doing the topic of clubbing, that time it will come. And you know why clubbing? Because see, one way minor's income is clubbed in parents. To club means to include. Income is of my daughter. But when you include it in mummy, papa, so you actually including means you are clubbing. Mummy, papa already they are having earning. And minor child income also mixed, so it gets clubbed. So for this there is a special topic only. So it is better to discuss at that time. So right now just by it as a rule that if a minor has earned the income, he or she will not pay the tax. Who will pay the tax? Either mummy or papa, whosever income is higher, and that parent will get an exemption of 1,500 per child. See, why per child? Because see, I might have 5 children. All are 10 years, 12 years, 11 years old. All are small child. And every child is having 10,000, 10,000, 10,000, 10,000 income. So for each child, I will get 1,500 exemption. And whenever there is an exemption, there is a section 10. Whenever there is an exemption, there is a section 10. And here the section is 10-32. 10, one was agriculture. 10-32 is income of minor child, income of minor child, okay. So this was first M. There are two M's. First is income of minor child, okay. Now see, there is one more M. Wait. First, what I have taught you, just have a glance over it. Actually, I have taught you M2 first. There are two M's. So what does M stand for here? Income of minor child. Okay. So did you see I have written the amount in the inner column?
Yes.
Why? I want to deduct 1,500. And after deducting 1,500, balance will come in the outer column. Okay. And see, this I cannot simply put dash. See, agriculture income, why did I put dash? Because there is no limit, it is fully exempt. What did I say? Fully means whether you earn in crores or 1,000 crores, no tax at all. So completely dash. But minor child income is fully exempt or partly?
Partly.
So whenever something is partly exempt, first write in the inner column, then remove that part, balance in outer column. Everything is logical. Okay. So whatever, see, this amount which I am circling will be given in the question. And what you have to minus is 1,500 per minor child. And you have to write the section 1032. And balance will come in outer column. And this is coming in whose statement? It is in the parent statement. Huh? This is a statement of parent. Father or mother, whosoever income is higher. Okay. Now, one more M is there. MPs and MLAs. Have you heard about MP, MLA? Member of Parliament. Member of Legislative Assembly. Elections are coming. Okay. So, Member of Parliament, Member of Legislative Assembly. these people get salary. And the salary which they earn, that is also income from other sources and taxable. You will have a doubt over here now. What doubt? See, first imagine I fight in some election and I win the election with maximum votes and I am appointed as a member of parliament and sometimes I get appointed as MLA, means member of, what did I say, member of legislative assembly. So I get the position of MP or MLA, then I get the salary also. And that salary is also income from other sources. So tell me here, what doubt you should have? Sir, one hand you are saying salary. So it should come in income from salary. But then here it's not coming. Here it's coming to income from other sources. Why? So see, the real answer for this is what, you know. See, something can be called as income from salary when, you know, when there is a master and servant relationship. I mean, you have to become servant and you will have a boss. There has to be employer-employee relationship. Employer means your boss, which I am calling here as a master. And employee is the servant who has to work as per the instruction or order of the boss. So only if that relationship exists, it becomes income from salary. But if you notice, MPs and MLAs, they are not employees. They are not job going people. They are not employees. Now student will not accept this thing. A student will say, sir, they are employees. How come you say they are not employee? MPs and MLAs are employee of government. Wrong. Do you think they are employees of government? You know, MPs, MLA, they themselves form the government. They are not employee of government. They themselves of government. Tell me, what is government? Is government a particular human being?
No.
Government is what? Narendra Modi, Prime Minister, and all the Chief Minister, MP, MLA. You make them stand at one place. And then you will say, this is government. Imagine a group of people. In the center, who is standing? Narendra Modi. And along with him, all the chief ministers and MPs, MLA. Imagine that whole group. What will you call? That whole group is government. So MPs, MLA is from the group of government. So they themselves are government. They are not working under someone as an employee. Now someone, no sir, they might be employee of Narendra Modi. Narendra Modi himself is a part of government. See, only thing, his position is high. Okay, Narendra Modi means highest position. Prime Minister, prime. Then comes Chief Ministers. Then comes MPs, MLA. See, that is the difference in the position. But what is the common feature? They are all forming
government.
Okay. So, they themselves are government. But then you will say, that, sir, then why salary? See, salary because they also have their family. Okay, so if I am Narendra Modi, if I am MP, MLA, don't you think I also have my family, my children, my wife, etc. I also need money for my survival. So you know what these people do? Whatever collection government gets collection from taxes. So whatever collection government gets, they take little bit from them. That little bit, who knows, little bit or whatever, but whatever, the collection of the government, from that they withdraw something. For example, see, this coaching class is my coaching class, I am the owner. So whatever profits I make, if I withdraw something for my wife and my children, will I call it a salary? This is my class only. Whatever collection I am getting as a fees from students, I am taking something. But why are you taking? I will take, then only my wife will be happy. Or should I keep the profits in the class only? So same with government. Government collects lot of money in the country. But these MPs, MLA, they withdraw something. But that doesn't mean it's a salary. If that would have been salary, then whatever I withdraw from my class, even that should be salary. I also withdraw from my class, but this is my class only. If I withdraw something, it's I'm withdrawing the profit. It's not salary, I'm not working under someone. So same goes with MP, MLA, it is their government only. Whatever collection they make, they take little bit. But they are not working under someone. They don't have a boss. Imagine if I become an MP or MLA, I will work as per my rules and regulation. I will decide. There is no fixed office timing. I have to go at that time. I have to come at that time. I will work as per my own wish. So I don't become an employee. And when you don't become an employee, the parliament, they have to incur some expense. For that, they get daily allowance. What did I say?
Daily allowance.
If daily allowance is received by MP, MLA, it is free from tax. It is exempt under section 10 is obvious. 17. Exempt under section 10? 17. Okay. And why exempt? See, whenever I say exempt, you should have the question why. You think why? Because you know, daily allowance income, they are not able to take the benefit of that. That daily allowance, although they receive, but it's almost spent. Spent on what? Attending the meetings in the parliament. See, daily allowance, the purpose of giving is what? Because they have expenses of attending parliament. And government thinks what, you know, MPs, MLA, they attend a meeting for the benefit of general public. But for that, they have to spend from their pocket. So that's why they are getting daily allowance. But that daily allowance is not enjoyed by them. It is almost spent. That's why government doesn't tax him. Okay. Now see, income tax means central government. MPs, MLA are not connected with central government. They are connected with local government. See, government also at three levels, central, state and local. Income tax which I am teaching, it is charged by central government. And MPs, MLA, they are part of the local government. Chief minister is state government. Okay. So MPs, MLA, they are not in the team of central government. So MPs, MLA, they have to follow central government ka income tax rules. And central government says MP, MLA, MP, MLA, your salary, you pay the tax. But that daily allowance which you get, it's exempt. On that you don't have to pay the tax. Okay. So did you notice that one who taxes is a central government of India. Okay. So see here, we were at M only. Read how I have shown here. Income of MP, MLA, if they get salary, see what I have written here. I have put dash or amount. Amount. Amount is a symbol of taxable. But daily allowance, it is exempt. That's why I put dash. And it is not partly exempt, also fully exempt. See, if something is partly exempt, first I will write in the inner column, then deduct it. But this is fully exempt, so dash. And in bracket what I will write, exempt under section 1017. See, till now three sections have come. 101 agriculture income, 1032 income of minor child, 1017 daily allowance received by MP, MLA. Okay. So M is done. Now Ramu, Ramu, U for units of mutual fund. You heard about mutual fund? Tell me what mutual fund does. For example, I am mutual fund. What I will do? I will collect the money from the public and I will invest in the stock market. I will invest in the share market. Because see, a general public is afraid to invest in share market. Why is afraid? He feels, what if my money is lost? So that's why a layman would be scared to invest directly in the share market. So if you want to invest through mutual fund, your money will be little safer. Because the mutual fund are very brainy people. They have full knowledge about stock exchange. So what they promise, you give your money to us. We will invest your money in the best portfolio of stock exchange. So that is the job of a mutual fund. So feel like this, public, mutual fund, stock exchange. Now how the income will flow? First, from the stock exchange, income will come to mutual fund. And then mutual fund will give to the investor. And for investor, it is income from other sources. For investors, it is income from other source, and even that is taxable. It is not tax free. So in short, this is called income from units of mutual fund. See, when you invest in a mutual fund, you don't become a shareholder. You become a unit holder. See, if you invest in a normal company, you become a shareholder. But if you invest in a mutual fund, you don't become a shareholder, you become unit holder. And the item which you hold is not called shares, it is called units. Okay. So what is the difference between shares and units? Shares is when you invest in a normal company who themselves do the business of buying, selling goods, etc. But if you invest in mutual fund, then it is not investment, it is called investment in units. And from that, whatever income you get, it is taxable. Yes?
Why is there not some capital gains?
See, a student has a doubt, sir, why this income from units of mutual fund doesn't come in capital gains? See, capital gains arises when you sell the property, sell. Tell me, your investor has invested in mutual fund and mutual fund gives him income on yearly basis. Are you selling something? No. Yes. The units which you are holding in a mutual fund, you can sell it. If you sell the units, then it is capital gains. You know why this doubt came to a student's mind? Because in day-to-day life, you hear many times, mutual fund sold, I have made capital gain. But see, capital gains comes from mutual fund. But when you sell the units, see, don't forget, the shares and units are saleable in market. So whether it is shares of a company or units of a mutual fund, this if you want, you can sell it. But if you sell it, it becomes capital gains. But if you don't sell, you hold, then you get a yearly income. From shares, you get dividend. From mutual fund, you just get income. But that is income from other source. Yes? It is realized. See, many students, see, when you invest in mutual fund, you get income check. Every year you get a check of income. See, a layman doesn't prefer much mutual fund income, but see, you get income. See, when you invest in mutual fund, you get income, but see, there is no certainty. Whether it is dividend or mutual fund, it is not certain that fixed every year you will get it. Dividend nature everyone might be knowing. Only if the company distributes, you will get it. But you might not get. But if they distribute, you get it. Then though you pay tax. Huh? Yeah. Similarly, mutual fund also, it's not necessary they will distribute it. They may distribute, they may not distribute. So if they are not distributing, then it doesn't become your income. Then you are right. But what if mutual fund is distributing your income? Then though you received income, that is income from other sources. See, actually dividend and mutual fund income are same only. Only difference is dividend comes from shares. And shares words are used when you invest in a company who himself is doing trading manufacturing activity. But when you say units, it is a mutual fund. They don't do any business. They further invest in stock exchange. But whether it is shares or units, there is no certainty that every year you will get income. But if you get, it is income from other source and taxable. But if you want to sell it, then capital gains. Holding income, IFOS. Holding income, capital gain. What did I say, IFOS? IFOS is a very famous statement, short form for income from other source. Say IFOS. Make it familiar. IFOS means income from other sources. Okay. So what was my last dialogue? If you hold, IFOS. If you sold, capital gain. Holding and solding. Solding is not a proper term, but I hope you understand. Holding income, IFOS. Okay. But if you don't want to hold it, you want to sold it, then income from capital gains. Okay. See, why did this point start? Because someone had a doubt, sir, why not capital gains? It will come in capital gains, but when you sold, but if you hold, then income from other source. So, this was the next point. Read. Income from units of UTI and mutual fund. See, now you will have a doubt. Sir, you read a UTI, you didn't talk about that. See, what is UTI, you know? Unit Trust of India. This is actually a government body. They are actually same as mutual fund. What mutual fund does? They take the money of public and invest in share market. Same thing is done by UTI. In fact, UTI was the first institute who started this concept of mutual fund in India. You know, for the first time, this concept, which concept? Take the money of people, invest in stock market. This concept started in India by government by the name of Unit Trust of India. They are the pioneer. But after they started, now though you will find so many mutual funds. Okay. Reliance Mutual Fund, SBI Mutual Fund, HDFC Mutual Fund, this, that. But they are all copycats. But who is the pioneer of mutual fund industry? UTI. So in short, sometimes in the question they write UTI, but you have to view it like a mutual fund only. And the treatment is same. Treatment is, look, I have written amount means it's taxable. Okay. So we have done Ramu. Now we go to Fakir. See, what is the keyword? It's funny, but it's good to remember the whole chapter. D.W. Ramu Fakir G. Now in Fakir, F stands for family pension. Family pension means, imagine an employee was doing the job, but he died. And after his death, wife is getting pension. And for wife, it is income from other sources. Wife will not say income from salary, because wife was not doing the job. Who was doing the job? Husband. But he died. Yes, if husband doesn't die, he has simply retired. Then he himself gets a pension. Then it is income from salary. See, pension you will find in two chapters. Income from salary, income from other source. That depends upon who is receiving the pension. If the employee who was working, who was doing the job, he himself is getting the pension on retirement, then it is income from salary. See, if you get something from your boss, so whether it is during the service or after retirement, the relationship is of employer and employee, that will come in income from salary. But then what if the employee dies? Then after his death, the wife is received by the family member. And when family members get the pension, we cannot call it as income from salary, because they were not doing the job. Okay. For them, it is income from other source. And that will come in this chapter as F in Fakir. Why F? Family pension. Read this. The next point is family pension after the death of employee. Can you tell me why I have given importance to the word death? Because if employee did not die, he has retired, means he is alive. Then though he is getting pension from his boss, then income from salary. Okay. So you have to be careful when you come across pension. Okay. See, in the first chapter you will not have tension, because in first chapter you are preparing income from other source statement only. But when you reach at advanced level, you have to prepare everything. See here, at the last stage of our subject, you will be capable to prepare everything. So imagine if a question is there where you have to do everything, then you have to do proper placement. So tell me, how will you decide where to place pension? If it is a retirement case, employee getting, then you will place it here. But if it is a death case, wife getting pension, then you have to place here. So that positioning knowledge is important. See, in the first chapter doesn't make much difference, because in first chapter your focus is to prepare this only. But you should know the position of every income. Okay. So family pension is done. Okay. But see, in family pension there is one exception. If the employee who died, he was working in Indian Army, and during his course in the army job, he died, and his family members are getting pension, then it is exempt under section 10-19. While I was explaining, only some emotions might have woke up. You are not emotional actually. What did I say? A person was working in Indian Army and he died. You are not feeling emotional? Army people, they are working 24/7 for the safety of our country. And imagine, he is working in Indian Army, and on the border, due to some war, India-Pakistan war attack, etc., whatever reason, he died. So it is an emotional situation. In such case, when his wife gets the pension, government out of emotion says tax-free, tax-free. Because he was a warrior who died. He was working in Indian Army. He has given his life for the country. See, a normal employee dies, government is not that emotional. Obviously, death is an emotional situation, but not that emotional, okay? But if a person who is working in Indian Army, if he dies, that means his death is dedicated to the whole country. So when death of an army employee takes place, then the pension received by the family member will not be taxable, it will be exempt. And once I say exempt, section 10 should come to your mind. And here it is 1019. It is exempt under section 1019. Okay, 1019. See, here I have not written. It will come somewhere written. But this is taxable, assuming it's a normal employee's death. Okay, tell me, what if that comes in the question? Army employee died and pension. Then you will not put amount. Then you will put dash. In fact, in bracket you will write? Exempt under section 1019. You have to write like this, okay? So, F is done. Next is A. A for award. Award, if you get from government, then salute. Exempt. Under section 1017A. But if you have got award from government, because see, when government is impressed and giving you award, that means definitely you have done some great job. And for such a great job, after you get the award, you are freed from tax also. Means there is no tax. But tell me, if I say, even I got an award, but from Goregaon Sports Club, from Lions Club. So these awards are not so valuable. These are not from government. See, there are many institutes, for some small thing also they give award. But these awards are not recognized. If you get such award, it will be taxable. But if you get award from government, then that means you have done something impressive, then it will be exempt. So look here, what I have written here, if award is received from government, you will put dash, because exempt under section 1017A. But if it is from others, it will be taxable. Okay. So we have reached to K now. What is the keyword? D.W. Ramu Fakir G. Actually, see, what is the purpose of giving the keyword, you know? See, if you buy out these incomes, you know, it becomes so simple for you. Whenever you come across this income, immediately it will strike. It is income from other source. Otherwise, you will have to wonder where to write this income. There are five heads of income, where to place it. But if you are well versed with this keyword, by heart and memorized, then looking at this income, immediately you can see, yes, this is income from other source. Otherwise, see, if you apply your brain, you don't have to buy out this. Any income which does not fit in four heads, it is understood income from other source. But who will use that much brain and put so much time? It's better that you buy out with the keyword, and if you are buy out it, looking at this income, you can immediately say it's income from other source. Then, next alphabet is K. K stands for Keyman Insurance Policy. K for? Keyman Insurance Policy. Think, what is Keyman Insurance Policy? Think. Keyman Insurance Policy. See, here you have to understand first the meaning of the word key man. What do you mean by the word key man? Key man means very important person of the organization. See, there are big companies, big organization. Okay, there are so many people involved in that, but there is some main person. Like when you think about Reliance, there are so many stakeholders in Reliance. But who is the main person of Reliance? Mukesh Ambani. That main person is called?
Keyman.
Okay. Now, let's take the example of Reliance only. Tell me, why Reliance will take a Keyman insurance? This is not an insurance taken by Mukesh Ambani himself. Huh? Mukesh Ambani insurance will be taken by Reliance. Because for Reliance as a company, Mukesh Ambani is the most important person. And Reliance feels Mukesh Ambani is the most important person. So why insurance for that? Most important. Keep it up. Very good. Now why insurance? See, insurance is taken when you are scared about something. So can you tell me, Reliance might be scared about what? Sudden death of Mukesh Ambani. See, right now Mukesh Ambani is alive. He is taking Reliance to a different heights. But you know, day by day Reliance might be feeling, now Mukesh Ambani is getting older by age. What if suddenly Mukesh Ambani dies? Who is fearing this? Reliance. See, first let me tell you, in the eyes of law, Mukesh Ambani is a different person. Reliance becomes a different person. This much you know, this you have studied in accounts or separate entity concept, okay? So Ambani is a human being, separate person. Reliance is a big company, separate person. So Reliance is afraid about what? What if Mukesh Ambani dies? And you know why to feel afraid here? If Mukesh Ambani dies, the business of Reliance will go for a toss. In the sense, Reliance will feel that business will start suffering losses. Why it will start suffering losses? Because see, such news becomes so viral. Ambani died, Ambani died. And you know what the layman say? Now Reliance is gone, now Reliance is gone. People talk so much. And indirectly it affects the business of Reliance. Suddenly Reliance might be having a sales of say 1000 crores. It will drop to 100 crores. So that will make Reliance suffer loss. So we are worried about that loss. So for that insurance. But tell me how insurance can help. How insurance can help. Did you understand Reliance is scared of what? If Ambani dies, he will die, his wife will cry. We are not worried about wife and children. We are worried about business. What will happen to our business? Our business will suffer losses. So we are worried about a loss in the business. So for that, you know how insurance companies will help. What insurance companies will say? You take an insurance policy with LIC. And till the time Mukesh Ambani is alive, every year you pay the premium to LIC. Premium, you heard or not? Premium. So every year we'll pay premium to LIC. And what is the advantage of paying the premium, you know? Suddenly within 2-3 years, Ambani dies. LIC will give me crores of amount. Me means I am Reliance. So with such a big amount received from LIC, I can survive in the bad state. Yes. Which bad state? Losses in the business due to the death of Ambani. So this is the advantage of Keyman insurance. See, why do you take fire insurance? You are worried, what if the godown, stock lying in the godown, if it is destroyed due to fire. So there, what advantage you get by insurance? Till the time there is no fire, keep paying premium. You pay premium to insurance company. And if there is a sudden fire, you get huge compensation from insurance company. So it's not that loss didn't occur. Loss occurred. But you can face the loss with that money. Similarly, if Ambani dies, loss will occur. But in such loss time, if LIC gives me a big compensation, I can survive. So that is called Keyman insurance policy. See, this way anyone can take Keyman insurance policy. Means whenever a company feels that our company is growing and growing, but it is dependent upon one main person. And if you are worried about the death of that person, you can take Keyman insurance policy. Actually, policy means an agreement. It becomes an agreement between Reliance and LIC. What will be the agreement? Every year we will pay premium. Okay. And in the agreement, what is written? If there is sudden death of Mukesh Ambani, LIC will give money to Reliance. Actually, Mukesh Ambani will not get anything. Mukesh Ambani is just a person for which we are worried. It's an agreement between Reliance and LIC. Whatever premium is to be paid, Reliance will pay. And on death of Ambani, LIC will give to Reliance. The money transaction is between company, Reliance and LIC. Ambani is just a point to decide whether in LIC will give the money or not. Okay. So now what to do? See, in income tax, whatever I talk about, your interest in should be in what? taxable or exempt? Come to the main point. Okay, so tell me, taxable or exempt? But dear, what is the income first? Yes, imagine Mukesh Ambani dies, God forbid. Okay, but let's, for our example sake, suddenly Mukesh Ambani dies. So what will happen? LIC will give a huge amount to Reliance. So think from Reliance point of view, Reliance is getting money. Money is coming in, income. This income is taxable. This will be fully taxable. Okay, but this is technically income from business. Why? Because Reliance was worried about business. Why did Reliance go for Cayman Insurance? Because Reliance was worried about what?
Business.
And to protect the business, if LIC gives the money, it is income from business. So how come I am talking about in the chapter income from other source? So see, explanation is still going on. Normally this is an income under the head business. First, do you agree with this? It should be business income. Obviously, because why Reliance did all this thing? Reliance has paid every year premium. Why? To protect and secure the business. So on sudden death of Ambani, if Reliance gets the money, obviously it has to be income from business, because the insurance was to protect the business. But sometimes, you know what happens? The thing which we have feared about, that Ambani will die, he doesn't die. It's good. He doesn't die. So you know, if Ambani doesn't die, so after 10-15 years, the policy matures. Have you heard about maturity? Maturity means LIC and Reliance has made an agreement for 10-15, say for example 10 years. They might have made agreement for 10 years, that if during 10 years Ambani suddenly dies, you will get a big amount suddenly, immediately you will get. But what if Ambani doesn't die? Then after 10 years the policy matures, and on maturity LIC will give the money. See, Reliance will definitely give the money. Sorry, definitely get the money. Okay. But if death happens suddenly, they'll get immediately. If death doesn't happen, then on maturity. Okay, now, what if Reliance gets the money on maturity? Then also it is income from business. See, whether event of death took place or maturity. After all, why did Reliance do all this? For business. So whatever LIC gives to Reliance, it is income from business only. But sometimes, you know what Reliance might do? Imagine LIC gave 5 crores. Imagine 5 crores rupees. This is a check with Reliance. So Reliance might do what, you know, it might give that money to Mukesh Ambani. Why? Because Reliance is so happy and they are so overwhelmed. Yes, Ambani is still alive. We were scared, what if he dies? Now he is still alive. The policy has matured. So whatever amount LIC gives to Reliance, Reliance actually feels that we don't need. See, need for insurance was what? If Reliance has to suffer loss. But Reliance will suffer loss if Ambani dies. But he didn't die. So Reliance is fit and fine. So it might happen. What might happen? What? That whatever Reliance gets from LIC on maturity, they might give that check to Ambani. And then for Ambani, it is income from other sources. Then it will come to income from other source. So there is a far, far chance. Mainly it is an item of income from business only. And see, this thing which I said right now, that policy has matured, LIC gives say 5 crores to Reliance, and the Reliance gives away that amount to Ambani. See, giving away to Ambani is not compulsory. Huh? But why I am making an example? So that I can make it as income from other sources. Understand my feeling?
Yes.
If I stick to one thing, why to give to Ambani? Why to give? Reliance has paid premium from its own pocket. They should keep the money. Okay, keep it then. Then though it is income from business.
Yes.
But here I am struggling hard to explain my students that it can become income from other source. So obviously the example has to go like that only.
Yes.
So conclusion, tell me, on death, on maturity. Tell me, on death, if LIC gives to Reliance, then? Then though Reliance itself will keep. Then Reliance is desperately needing the money. because Ambani died, Reliance is suffering loss, they need the money, they will keep, and then though it is always income from other source, but income from business, but that is if death. But what if there is maturity? Then LIC's duty is to give it to Reliance only. They cannot give directly to Mukesh Ambani. Because LIC got the premium from the pocket of Reliance. So duty of the LIC is to give the money to Reliance. And if Reliance keeps it with it, business. But if Reliance gives it to Mukesh Ambani, then for Mukesh Ambani income from other source. And then he will pay tax. Reliance will not pay. Because Reliance has passed on. See here, all this you can, whatever I explained, it is everything drawn over here. Can you see my example? Same example, okay. See, this is Ambani, this is Reliance. Okay, and agreement is between Reliance and LIC. And let's assume there is a policy of 20 crores. Okay, see, this policy amount is agreed in advance between Reliance and LIC. Okay, now Reliance will have to pay every year. Can you see the arrow which I am drawing? Reliance will have to pay premium. See, this insurance is not free of cost. Every year you have to pay premium. But premium is not a big amount. It is a nominal amount which you have to pay on year to year basis. So see, Reliance will pay premium. Okay, and then later LIC will give 20 crores. But when will LIC give? Either on death or maturity, whichever happens first. If death happens first, immediately on death they will have to give. If death doesn't happen, then on maturity. So, and this 20 crores will be income from business for Reliance. And see, T means what? Taxable. Understanding? And what if Reliance gives away the money to Ambani? Then Reliance won't pay the tax. Then Ambani will pay tax under the head income from other sources. Okay. But see, this is a rare chance. Why rare? Because see, obviously Reliance will think what? We have paid the premium. So whatever we get, we will keep the money. So 99% Reliance will keep the money. It will become income from business only. But by chance, if it gives to Ambani, anything is possible in life. Then it is income from other sources. Okay. In our question, they will mention the details properly. Don't worry. You should have the knowledge. Data will be provided in the question. Okay. Okay. Now see here. One good point here. Here Reliance was worried about what? If Mukesh Ambani dies, because of his death, business will suffer. But tell me, don't you think because of Ambani's death, his family will also cry? Yes. Who is the wife of Mukesh Ambani? Neeta Ambani. Neeta Ambani, Mukesh Ambani's children, they will also be affected when Mukesh Ambani dies. So who will think of that? So that Reliance will not think. Reliance will say, we think about our dhanda. In Hindi, dhanda means what? Business. So Reliance will say, we are not worried about Mukesh's family. Let them cry, let them go to hell. We are thinking about business. So when they think about business selfishly, then it is key man. But Reliance might not be worried about his family. Ambani cares for his family. Mukesh cares for his family. So for that, Mukesh will take policy. Mukesh will enter into an agreement with LIC. And Mukesh will say, LIC, I am giving you premium every year. But remember, when I die, I give the money to my family. That is a normal life insurance. That is not key man. So what I wanted to say, there are two types of insurance related to the death. Key man, life insurance. What is the difference in my example? Key man will be taken by Reliance to secure the business. Life insurance will be taken not by Reliance. It will be taken by Mukesh Ambani himself. And key man is to secure the business. Life insurance is to secure the family. Key man is for business money minded people. That's why taxable. But life insurance is taken by a human being as a money-minded or family-minded?
Family-minded.
So they will be exempt. Means if it is a normal life insurance policy, the money received from LIC, it is tax-free. But normal life insurance policy, who will take? Mukesh Ambani will enter into an agreement with LIC, in which Mukesh Ambani every year he will pay premium, and when he dies, his family will get. That thing is not key man. That is normal life insurance, and that is exam, because that is money-minded people or family-minded people? Family-minded people. And that is exam under section 10. It has to be 10. In bracket 10D. Did you notice in our conversation, I have introduced one more point. Actually, I discussed two points in K. Alphabet K, points 2. First point was key man. Second point was life insurance. In short, you should watch for the spelling. If the spelling of insurance is key man, make it taxable. If the spelling is life insurance, then you should know it is life insurance, not by money-minded people. It is for family-minded people. So out of emotion, government also thinks that life insurance you take to care of your family. Such a caring people. So when family gets the money, it will be free from tax under section 1010D. Okay. So this was K. Okay, then Fakir. Fakir. After K, the next alphabet is I. Interest income. Have you heard about interest income? Obviously, yes. See, many times you invest somewhere. See, mostly from your investment you get interest. See, actually there are three incomes from investment. If you invest in share market, dividend, mutual fund, it's income. We just call it as income. Shares, dividend, mutual fund, income. But other places where you invest, you get interest income. And interest income is also taxable.
Yes.
But there are certain interest incomes which are tax free. You know which are those? Look here. No. There are, what did I say last sentence? There are certain interest income which are tax free. You wanna know what are those? Look here. Look. There is a keyword. GPS. GPS. In this keyword, whatever points you learn, they are all exempt. In short, you will have to by heart. G, P1, P2. There are two P's. And S. Count how many? Four. There are four items of interest income which are exempt. Rest all are taxable. So you should watch for in the exam paper. If you come across G, P, S, then your answer should be exempt. Then you will put dash. See, the full form is G for gold bonds. Interest on gold bonds. What is gold bonds? Debentures, bonds, you heard. But see, in gold bonds, what happens, you know, you have to deposit gold. See, in normal investment, you invest money. But in gold bonds, you have to invest gold. So imagine I have got 2 kgs gold at my home. And I am feeling my gold sitting at home, it is sitting idle. Gold appreciates. But is the gold kept at my home giving me yearly interest? No, it is lying idle at my home. So what I might think, I can give my gold to government. And in return, they will give me a certificate. They are called bonds. See, bonds and debentures and shares are what? They are certificate. So I will give my gold to government. They authorized all the banks to open PPF account. But the account is the property of central government, where people money invest the money. And why it is called public provident fund? Why public? Because there is one more provident fund which is in the job. See, when you do some job, there also there is a provident fund or not. But that is different. That is for job going people. Here we are trying to say this is for general public. So by the word public, we mean to say it is not for an employee. It is for everyone. It is for a child old people, young people, everyone. It has got no connection with your job. That's why the name Public Provident Fund. Okay. And this account, because it is government's account, the interest is tax free. See, in gold bonds also the logic was government. PPF account is also maintained by government. And wherever government is there, government does marketing. What marketing? See, if you invest here and there, unnecessary you will have to pay tax. But if you invest with us, your income will be tax free. So purposely the rules are made in such a way so that people get diverted to government. Gold bonds. Okay. Then next was PPF. And then comes POSBA. You know what is POSBA? Post office, savings, bank, account. Post office, savings, bank, account. We commonly call it as POSBA. Say POSBA.
POSBA.
Post office, savings, bank account. Okay. In this also, wait, by the way, post office, why post office? You know, post office doesn't do the work of only sending the letters. Post office also started a banking type business. Actually, post office, the concept of post office was what? We used to send letter, they used to transport our letters and send us back our letters. So that was the main job of post office. But nowadays, post office does less of letter business. They are more into banking. So there are various schemes of investments in post office. Just as you have a savings account in bank, you can also have a savings account in post office. And if you have a savings account in post office, your interest is tax free. That is called post office savings bank account. See, there are many schemes in post office. All these schemes are not tax free. Which is tax free? Savings bank account. What if in the exam say post office monthly income account? Something like this exists in real life. Huh? So if the question says post office on monthly income account, then don't say exam. Taxable. See, many students, what they do, just by looking at the word post office exam. Wrong. It should be post office savings bank account. Then only you should say exempt. And there is a limit here. There is a limit here. Wait. 3,500. Maximum 3,500 will be exempt. If you have a savings account in post office. Okay. But tell me, if you have a savings account in a bank, then it will be taxable. But yes, having a savings account in bank is also advantageous, but that advantage I will not explain now. I will explain at this stage. Look here. You know, there is something called deductions here. At that time, you will understand it is good to have a savings account in bank also. But see, that thing I don't want to mix here. You know, if I bring the knowledge of other chapters now, you will get mixed up. But still, I am narrating this also. Why? You know, because some students have knowledge as a general knowledge. So they might be thinking, sir, we have heard that in bank also, if you have savings account, there is some benefit. Yes, I know that. But from my side, that point will come at a later stage. Right now, just remember, having a savings account in bank, taxable. But having a savings account in post office, exempt up to 3,500. Okay. And see, by the way, section is what you know. For gold bonds, it is 10-15. And for POSBA also, 10-15. But for PPF, it is 10-11. Okay. Then one more thing is there. Sukanya Samridhi account. Sukanya Samridhi account. That is also exam under section 10-11A. 10-11A. Sukanya Samridhi account. You know what is this Sukanya Samridhi account? If anyone has a girl child, you can open an account in the name of girl child for the future of girl child. So if you have a girl child, if you have an account in bank by the name Sukanya Samridhi account, the interest on that is tax free. Logic is what you know. In India, there are many parents who don't care about girl child. If they have a son, a boy, they feel proud. But if the children is in the form of a female, girl, they don't treat properly. See, nowadays modern parents are not like that. I am talking about traditional community. And till today in India, you will find in villages, the culture is like that only. What they do, they don't give importance to girl child. See, I am not thinking about modern mentality. I am talking about that traditional mentality. So that's why what government feels, you know, they feel bad. That why you are not giving importance to girl child. So that's why Narendra Modi, few years back, he started a scheme called Sukanya. Sukanya means a girl child. Samriddhi means growth. Sukanya Samriddhi account. This kind of account, central government started by the instruction of Narendra Modi. And in that account, you know what they say? If any parent has a girl child, open a special account for that girl child, dedicated for that girl child only. So that with that bank account, the girl's future is secured. Otherwise, parents don't care about the future of girl child. So that's why this kind of account has started. And to promote this, the income is made tax-free. See, government has to promote something, so they have to give some attraction. So what is the attraction given by government? Exemption. Otherwise, see, if government simply says, open this account with no attraction, no incentive, people will never do that. But because government has given exemption, every parent nowadays have Sukanya Samriddhi account. Even I have opened an account. I also have a girl child by the name Anika. She is 16 years old. 3-4 years back only I have opened an account for her. See, I am not that kind of person who don't give importance to girl child. But still, nowadays everyone is having that kind of account so that if something happens to us, our girl child is secured. Okay. Anyways, this was just a background. Point is, in the exam, if you see Sukanya Samriddhi account, actually they will write interest. Huh? Don't forget, these are all interest incomes. But interest from where? Sukanya Samriddhi account. Taxable or exempt? Exempt. Amount or dash? Dash. Section 10-11A. I remember this A because my daughter is Anika. A for Anika. I have also opened account for my daughter Anika. Which account? Sukanya Samriddhi account. Okay, what was just 10-11? That was public provident fund account. And what was 10-11A? Sukanya Samriddhi account. Actually, see, PPF account and Sukanya Samriddhi, both accounts you have to open in some bank only. But they are actually account of central government. And that's why they have kept the section also similar. Only thing is, PPF is for general public savings. But this is for girl child. But both the accounts you open with bank, but they are owned by government, central government. So section is 11 only, but 10-11 is PPF, 10-11A, Sukanya Samriddhi account. Okay. So these are the four interest incomes which are exempt. See, as a student, you should remember like this. Gold bonds, POSBA, PPF, Sukanya. Gold bonds, POSBA, PPF, Sukanya. Remember this in a tune. Gold bonds, POSBA, PPF, Sukanya. Gold bonds, POSBA, PPF, Sukanya. Gold bonds, POSBA, PPF, Sukanya. Gold bonds and POSBA, 10-15, PPF, 10-11, Sukanya, 10-11A. Gold bonds, POSBA, PPF, Sukanya. But if you come across some interest income which is not from gold bonds, POSBA, PPF, Sukanya, then it is taxable. Okay, what if the question says interest on debentures of Infosys? Taxable. See, they can give anything. And many students get affected. What is this? This thing sir has never taught. What sir has not taught is taxable. Take it for granted. Sir is here to teach those which are exempt. But if you find some novelty in the exam, interest on deposit certificates of ABC Limited Company, any weird thing you come across, what you should think? Interest income. It is not from GPS. Taxable. Okay. This was I. D.W. Ramu Fakir G. Fakir R. 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 R for royalty income. Tell me, what is royalty income? If I write a book, okay, for example, I have written a book on CA final direct tax. My CA final direct tax book has been published all over India. But you know, in that, what I have done? Book I have made. It is my notes, my dictation, everything is my, it is my creation. But that book's copyright I have given to a publisher in New Delhi. My publisher is in New Delhi. The name is Commercial Law House. And you know what they do? Publisher means what? They will print my book and they will sell the book in the whole country. So I am the author. I wrote my direct tax book for CA final and that book I gave to the publisher. In fact, I have to give the copyrights. Means in the sense I have to give them a right that I give you, it is my creation. So I give them the right to publish and sell in market. But I will charge some commission. And that commission is technically a royalty income, not commission. Commission sounds very cheap. When you've done some royal work, royal, the word should be royalty. And I'm justifying, why royalty? Have I done some local work or writing a book? Writing a book requires intelligence, it requires creativity. So it is not just a local thing I've done, it is some royal work. So for that, that publisher will give me kind of commission in local language, means whatever books he sells, he gives me 10% of that. He sells the books across India, I have given him right. But whatever sale takes place, 10% of that he gives to me. And that becomes my royalty, that becomes my income from other sources. Why income from other source? I am not a writer by my profession. My business is coaching class. Writing the books is my side income. That is why income from other source. But if I shut down the coaching class and if I become a professional writer only, day and night writing, printing the books, getting royalty, then it becomes a business. Then income from business. See, what I am trying to say, royalty can be business also. It can be other source also. It depends upon, is writing the books your business or not? If it is business, income from business. If not, income from other source. I have not made this as my business. My business is to teach in the class by teaching and generating the revenue. Writing the books is my side income. This one book I have written, I don't write it on regular basis. Okay. So for me, it is income from other source. See, students have a doubt, sir, in exam what to do? Should we take it as income from business or what? They will write. If they say the person is a professional writer, it is his business, then income from business. Then it will not come in this statement. Then it will come in a different statement. You know, for each income, different statements. Here it will come if it is not your business. So I have given a disclaimer already. Here I have taken royalty assuming it is not my business. And amount means taxable. It is not exempt. I have not done some great job. I am writing the books. I am also earning the income. Government says pay the tax. Okay, then this was R. D. W. Ramu Fakir G. G stands for gift. Next point is gift. Now gift income, G for gift income. Gift is also treated as income. And even that is sometimes taxable, sometimes exempt. But actually see, their theory of gift is very much in detail. There is a detailed discussion on gift. And discussion is about that only. When taxable, when exempt, and there are so many variations and combination in that, it becomes a big theory to be discussed later. Right now, I will keep the theory of gift on hold. Okay, means you will be curious to still know, sir, taxable, exempt, at least tell us. I can't say, because that is a detailed discussion. Sometimes taxable, sometimes exempt. But if it is possible to explain in short, I would have done it right now only. And at the initial stage, I don't want to launch that big theory. See, I have made a chart for this also. See, there is a, that will come later. There is a big theory for that. Can you see this chart?
Yes.
Okay. But I don't want to touch that theory right now. So for gift, I would say to be discussed later. So see, I have written here also. To be discussed later. And see, here I have written in a diplomatic manner. Amount also, dash also. Can't say until I explain. If taxable, then amount, exempt, then dash. Okay, see, one thing, look here. In DW, Ramu Fakir Ji, can you see one etc?
Yes.
What do you mean by etc? There can be more incomes other than DW Ramu Fakir Ji. But that I am not taking in my discussion. But if you say, but sir, what if some other income comes in, you know, taxable? See, what I have done, you know, most popular incomes. Popular in real life, popular in exam questions. Those popular income I have taken in the list. Otherwise, see, there is no end to the types of income. You can have any type of income. Many incomes nowadays you have never heard of. But it's okay, they are not so popular income. In worst case, if it comes in exam, what to do? Taxable. And in taxable, you don't have to do anything, something great. You just have to write the income with the amount. But just keep in mind, the world doesn't end in DW Ramu Fakir Ji. The world is big. There can be other incomes, but all others are taxable. Okay. Now, can you tell me, in this whole list, which incomes were exempt? Broadly, did you notice in the big list, some incomes are taxable, some are exempt. And what the student has to remember is? So, can you tell me right now? So, many points have come actually speaking. So, now you know what I will do? We will analyze properly which incomes were exempt. I will make a list of that. Because we have to focus on that and by heart. So, see, there is a list over here. Look at this. Look. Did you realize these many exemptions you studied today? And this you should by heart. Because see, once you by heart this, rest all income you just have to remember taxable. And in taxable income, you just have to write the amount in the outer column. That's it. But in exempt income, you have to be careful. You will put amount or dash, dash. And in bracket, you have to write the section also. So tell me one by one. What was 10-1?
Agriculture
income. Very good. 10-1 is agriculture income. Then, wait. 10-17. What was 10-17? Wait. What was 10-17? Daily allowances received by MPs and MLAs. Didn't I say MPs, MLA, they have to attend parliament meetings. So most of the amount gets spent in that only. So for that, whatever daily allowance they get, it's tax-free. Okay. So, check here. MP allowance. Sorry, MP, MLA, daily allowance. Then next is what? 10-17A, award. Award from government is exempt. But award from non-government entities, not exempt. Then, 10-19, you might feel this section has come. Yes, it has come. When an army employee dies and after the death of army employee, the family gets the family pension, then for the family it is exempt, provided the employee was army employee. Then 10-32 is income of minor children. Minor children income, who pays the tax? Parents, father or mother, whosoever income is higher. But it is exempt only up to 1,500 per child. Then, 10-10D. No, it was taught at the time of key man. But key man as such is taxable. Because key man is money minded people. If Ambani dies, what will happen to business? Key man is taxable, life insurance. You should be able to identify. If they write key man, then take it taxable. But if it is life insurance, exempt. Because life insurance taken to secure the family. Family minded people, exempt. Then, See, this three comes in gold bonds, POSBA, PPF, Sukanya. See what the way I am highlighting. Look here. Gold bonds, POSBA. This is 10-15. PPF 10-11. Sukanya 10-11A. And the way I said was gold bonds, POSBA, PPF, Sukanya. Gold bonds, POSBA, PPF, Sukanya. All were interest incomes. Okay. This is interest income from gold bonds and POSBA. And PPF 10-11 Sukanya Samridhi account 10-11A. Okay. These section you have to by heart. Okay. Now see, to by heart this section, I have got one technique. But that technique is involving some Hindi. Although these are video lectures fully explained in English language. But there is some technique which I can explain with Hindi language only. So excuse me for this. Just to remember the technique of by heart the section, I am using Hindi for that. Okay. Otherwise, all the lectures will be completely in English language. See, conceptually I have explained totally in English, but there are certain techniques to remember which suits in Hindi language only. Okay. So if a student is watching the lecture from South, don't worry, little bit Hindi you might be knowing. Okay. See here, 10-1. How to remember 10-1? In India, some English will be there, but some Hindi will be there. So manage with that. In India, agriculture is given last importance or first importance?
First importance.
So what is this? One.
One.
So section also one. See, section 10 is a list of exempt incomes. But in that, number one, agriculture. Because agriculture is number one in the priority for the whole country. If there is no agriculture, how will we eat the food? So, because India gives agriculture first importance, section 10-1. Okay. Now, see, this you can remember like this. You know, in Hindi we say, Satra pe khatra. Satra pe khatra. Khatra is actually for danger, danger. But in Hindi we commonly say, Satra pe khatra. So, now listen what I'm saying. Satra pe khatra. Khatra matlab government. We call government as danger only. So see, how do I relate here? Satra pe khatra, khatra se government, government ke log, government ka award, government, government ke log, government ka award, government ke log, government ka award. Are government ke log means people of government. MP, MLA, they are people of government. And government ka award means award from government. But the common thing is government. And how do you relate government with 17? 17 in Hindi is Satra. And Satra pe Khatra, and Khatra means government. We call government as Khatra only. Although government is working for our benefit, but don't you think in our day-to-day communication, we always keep criticizing government. Our government is this only, they are torturing us. Actually, they might not have that intention. So casually we say Khatra government. So Satra means Khatra. Khatra is government. So with government, there are two points. Government people, government award. Government people, government award. People means MP, MLA. They are actually government people and government award. Okay. Then, and see one more thing. A for award. See, 17 gives you the hint. It is something. Satra means, Khatra means government. But with that, if there is A for award. See, if you want to remember something, you have to relate it with something. This is called memory of technique of association. If you associate, relate something, then you can remember. See, there are two choices. Either that thing you keep repeating 1,000 times. But that way you will never remember. Thing is, that thing you try to relate, connect, associate. That is called technique of association. Then you can remember in a shorter way. Just the way I did, one are related with first importance. And it makes sense also. Agriculture is given first importance. So that relating activity will make you memorize. Okay. And 17 are related with Satra, Khatra, government. And then along with that A, so award. Then 19, see how I am relating. See, have you seen in Bollywood movies? Many times you see in the movie, a person has joined army And suddenly after 1 or 2 months, the news comes to the family, he died in border. And in movies you have seen many times that army employee was just married. He just got married with a young bride, and suddenly when he went on a duty on army, he died. So that wife becomes widow. And here you have to say 19 साल की अबला नारी बिचारी की नई नई शादी हुई थी, शादी के बाद पति आर्मी में गया और उसकी मर गई और बेचारी को पेंशन मिल रहा है. अरे 19 मीन्स आई एम रिमाइंडिंग यू द एज मीन्स हियर यू हैव टू थिंक लिटिल फिल्मी इन एंड एक्चुअली फिल्मी व्हाट इन रियल लाइफ इट हैज हैपेंड मेनी टाइम्स. यू नो न्यूली मैरिड कपल, बट यू नो इन दैट कपल द बॉय हैज द पैशन फॉर वर्किंग फॉर इंडियन आर्मी, बट दैट न्यूली मैरिड कपल, सो न्यूली मैरिड कपल द वाइफ विल बी अराउंड 19 ईयर्स. आई एम टॉकिंग अबाउट ट्रेडिशनल इंडिया. 19 ईयर्स गर्ल न्यूली मैरिड टू आर्मी एम्प्लॉई, सडनली आफ्टर 1 or 2 months अ न्यूज कम्स ऑन अ फोन, ही डाइड ऑन बॉर्डर. इट्स रॉन्ग टू से ऑल दिस बैड थिंग्स, बट आई एम जस्ट मेकिंग अ स्टोरी टू रिलेट 19 विद द एज ऑफ दैट फीमेल. And why I am talking about it? Because that female is getting the pension after the death of the husband working in Indian Army. So just relate with this. In Hindi, when I say like this, 19 saal ki abla jawan, nahi nahi shaadi hui thi, newly married, pati army mein gaye the, husband went to army, suddenly died, and now she is getting pension. But for that, government has sympathy. What sympathy? Fully exam. So relate this 19 years old female, her husband went to army and died. And 19 is a perfect age when you relate with some movies. Okay, nowadays at 19 no one gets married. Okay, now 10-32. This is for minor children. See, minor means what? Whose age is below 18. And you know when you are below 18, you don't get full 32 teeth. Hindi mein we don't say 32. 32 means 32 is a number which we say 32. And in Hindi many times we say minor bachcha to wo hai jiska 32 bhi nahi aaya. Aur 32, you know or not, we all have 32 teeth. But we get fully mature 32 teeth when? When you become a matured major. But when you are minor, 5 years, 6 years, 10 years old, you don't get full 32 teeth. So relate 32. 32 is a number of teeth which you get only when you become major. But minor is a person who has not yet got full 32 teeth. To relate that 32. Anyways, in Hindi lecture I say, minor wo hota hai jiski abhi bhi 32 nahi aayi hai. 32 means 32 teeth. Okay. Then, life insurance. Life insurance, who takes? Who is worried about death? D for death. D for death. Tell me, if I also take life insurance, what is the reason? I am worried about my death. What if I die? What will happen to my wife and children? So it is about the worry of death. So death starts with D. So relate this D. See, you have to relate something. And only if you can relate, you can remember. Here it is very difficult to find some technique. But still I have struggled to find some technique for this. Wait, I will come to 10-15 at the end, because that technique is not so impressive, but I will come to that. First 10-11. See, 10-11 is for PPF. You know, for PPF, I tell my Hindi batch, PPF account is so famous that ek-ek ke paas PPF account hota hai. Ek-ek. Ek and ek means 11. Ek means 1. Okay, and actually it is, I am not just saying for the sake of it. You do a survey in your whole city. Ask everyone, do you have PPF account? 99% people will say yes. So it is such a popular account. Which account? PPF. Ek-ek ke paas PPF account hota. Ek-ek ke paas. When every person has, in Hindi what we say? Ek-ek ke paas. So ek and ek means 11. Okay, and just as PPF account nowadays government has opened Sukanya, so the section is same. And my daughter is Anika. I remember like this only. So 11a, I have opened Sukanya account for my daughter. And just saying for the sake of explanation, actually my daughter Anika, for that we have opened an account called Sukanya Samriddhi account in State Bank of India. So I remember Anika, Sukanya account A for Anika. Or 11 makes me remember, just as government has started PPF account, you can open with any bank, they also have a scheme called Sukanya account. Both these schemes are run by government. So both have 11. But A is for that my daughter relation, Anika. Anyways, every daughter will not have Anika. But for you, I am the teacher. You remember with my daughter, okay? Now what is remaining is 10-15. What was in 10-15 actually? Gold bonds and POSBA. See, here you know what technique I made. Forcefully one technique I created. Just count the number of alphabets in interest incomes. If you count the number of alphabets in interest income, it will come 15 exact. See, you should remember interest incomes. It has how many alphabets? Let us count together. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. And interest incomes, S, there are two incomes. Gold bonds, POSBA. It is just one or two. Two, both are interest incomes. And when you count the number of alphabets in interest incomes, it comes to 15. So that way you can relate. And see, once you relate, you convince your mind to hell with the world. You have to remember. Okay. See, this way you can make any story, anything you can make. But right now you don't have a choice. I am the teacher for you. So what I have made, remember that way. And trust me, people are able to remember with this technique perpetually for a longer duration. Okay. So see, till now whatever I taught, it has become successful. Success depends upon if you remember the exempt incomes, that's it. Rest all is taxable. Whether it's D, W, Ramu, Fakir, G, everything is taxable. But these items are exempt. Okay. So tell me in one go fast. Fast. Okay. What was 10-1? Agriculture income. Then 17 MPMLA. Satra Khatra government ke log. MPMLA. Okay. Then 10-17 A for award. Government award. Satra relates to government now. Okay. Then 19 years young girl. Newly married to a boy. Boy went to army, died. Wife crying. Government emotional exam 10-19. Then minor child is a child who doesn't have 32 teeth. 32. Then life insurance is taken by people who are worried about death, D for death. Then 10-15 interest incomes. Number of alphabets in interest income 15. Gold bonds and POSBA. Then PPF 10-11. PPF account is so famous that everyone, AKK bus PPF hota hai, 11. And 10-11 A, Sukanya Samriddhi account. Okay. Tell me, all were fully exempt, but two items were not fully exempt. Minor child income is exempt up to 1500 per child. Remember? Similarly, here there was POSBA. No, PPF there was no limit. In POSBA it was 3500. But see, if POSBA is a joint account means there are two account holders. Then 7000 is the exemption. Because government wants to give 3500 exemption per account holder. And in a joint account, there are two account holders. Two people have invested. And for one person, it is. And the third thing is this iPad notes. iPad notes, I would insist that you write. Because only when you write, you will be able to remember. And writing this will not take much time. Because these notes are so crisp and precise. And you are so impressive that while you see in the mobile, you can traveling. And while traveling also, you can revise. Because these notes, I will give you the access in mobile app. In the mobile app, you will find these notes given in one folder. That PDF you can see, but you will not be able to download. you will not be able to print. Okay, you will have to write this. If you say, sir, give this also printed, then what will you do? That theory you are getting printed, questions you are getting printed, everything ready made, you will do something or the other not. So this thing you will have to write, and write it as neatly as it appears here. See how neatly I have written here, with the same color combination, red and blue, with that same color combination, everything you have to write. See, this is a recap of today's lecture. We started with this, this you will write first, then this, then this, then this, then this, everything you will have to write, and you will write till here. This will be the last page. Don't write anything further, okay? Write only this much, okay? And in fact, I will do one thing. I will provide this much only in the mobile app, so that your mind doesn't get diverted on extra things. Write this much, okay? And see, one more thing, let me tell you. Every lecture, I have the habit of asking question. Not to torture and humiliate you. It's my way of taking care. I'm caring, okay? And to care for my student, I have to see to that they are studying or not. And whether you're studying or not, I cannot believe. I have to ask question. So next lecture, when I enter the class, I will ask you the question. For example, I can say, Vishakha, you tell me the list of all examined income. You will have to tell me. If you're not able to say, I will not torture you. I will not shout at you. We are not that school teacher. And you should also not feel afraid. I have to answer in front of the whole class. We have to feel friendly. Because see, if this culture becomes a dangerous thing, then it will rather break it instead of making up a good thing. My purpose is we have to constructively take it in a positive way. That's why, you know, my approach is what? If a student is not able to answer in the class, I never shout at it. It's okay. Revise. You try. Anyone try. I will never make your position in an embarrassing situation that I am not able to answer. Sir will shout at me. Trust me, I will not do anything. But God is watching everything. If you don't study and come, sir will not shout. But God is going to shout, okay? And you are not answerable to the world. You are answerable to God. So you have to impress the God by answering me every lecture in the class, okay? So please revise and come. At the end of every lecture, I have the pattern of saying, revise and come. Revise and come. Please revise and come. And please come on time, okay? Bye.